all your friends about me.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
It's not college basketball. It's Clarence
time! Let's get ready to rumble! Feel the fires into the rear. It's my son only know how.
What is up, Friday Nighters? It was a little bit of a clunky start. What is up, Friday Nighters? My name is CM Chuck.
Hey, I'm Double A.
We are Just Another Friday Night, San Antonio's premier pop culture podcast, live on Friday nights with pee breaks. Sorry that we are late. It's hot here, super hot. So that affected me. And I'm also off the booze for a little bit here. No particular reason, just trying to rejuvenate my liver before September, when my sister's birthday, my birthday, OxCon is like gonna be it's gonna be a rough one. So yeah, but also I'm in a little weight loss competition at work, so I'm trying to like shed a few, and I know that the not drinking definitely does that for me.
Yes, it sure does.
Double A, how the hell are you, bud?
Man, good, but really getting burnt. If you guys can't tell, I'm like over here. I'm just fucking burning outside.
Yeah, you have passed my beach tan already, I think. So for sure. Everyone in the chat that's here already live, thank you so much for your patience. We appreciate being here. Let's give some shout outs. Toy Mafia says, yo, always first in the house. We appreciate you, Toy Mafia. Lane Kramer says,
hi, Toy Mafia.
Hey, with Mafia Mania. And he says, I like this.
This is my favorite Superman Elseworlds story.
Lane, I hope you will stick around for the conversation, because I am very eager to pick the brain of someone that has had a lot of familiarity with this story. It says, Toy Marcus says, yo to Lane. And then I said, sorry, we're late. That was me. So, and I am sorry that we're late, guys. What else, Double A? Adrenalize, your brother. Was there news in the world of pop culture this
week?
A lot of news.
There's a big brawl in Montgomery, Alabama.
Yeah.
Man, oh, man.
Which, you know, it's funny because stuff like that is like pop culture now, right?
Because it became like everyone was throwing memes at it and all this kind of shit. And
the guy swimming and the chair, fucking, dude, I was just brutal. In stitches, Double A. Brutal. I was like, I mean,
he fucking popped her hard on that fucking chair shot. Like, boom.
I didn't even know a croc could bust like that out the front. And then the guy swimming. I mean, like, kind of heroic, right? Like, or just a guy eager to fight. Like,
yeah, man. I was like, damn. Like, people are like, when the hat went up, like, the one I saw was like, when the hat went up, it was a call to Wakanda. I was like, damn.
Wow. Man. Yeah, seriously, man. That shit was so crazy.
Hey, what's up, Jason? Jason, I hope you had a good birthday.
Yeah, I hope you had a great birthday, brother. Sorry I haven't had a chance to get to the mailbox. Dude, getting to the post office is hard, man. But maybe tomorrow, hopefully, I'll get out there, get you a little something in the mail for your birthday, brother. We appreciate you always supporting us and being here.
Yeah, and then some Saturday news, Maui, that city, town in Maui is just gone. It's gone.
Really?
It burned up.
Everything. I don't think I heard about this.
You haven't heard of it? Yeah. The huge wildfire in Maui, it burned that town. Like,
oh my God.
To the ground. Like, there's no homes. There's nothing. No businesses. Nothing. Like,
just a random act of nature type fire?
Some fire happened. They said hurricane was coming. Kind of the winds kind of pushed that fire to other parts of the island. And it burned down. Like, Hawaii is asking people, like, not to make any plans to go to Hawaii, because they're trying to get all the hotels to shelter these people.
Wow.
In the meantime. And yeah, I mean, that island, whatever town, like I said, I'm not sure how you say it completely. It starts with an L, but it's burned to the ground. Like,
insane. I had not heard that story.
So,
wow.
Man, it happened like a few days ago, so that kind of sucks.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, prayers to those people.
Yeah, and their real families. And then my wife kind of told me some kind of shitty news. She was like, Southwest Airlines, is that right?
Uh-huh.
Southwest?
Yeah.
They're like, since this happened to the poor people, to try to get them off the island, we're only going to charge you $20 to get on the plane. I'm like, man, like, they lost everything. You know, I'm like, who knows what the fuck these people lost? But I mean, it's not like they're going to pop out a 20 anytime soon or go to the local bank anytime soon. You know?
Yeah,
like,
seriously.
Like, man, $20? Like, how about you just bring the fucking plane and try to get these people out of here? Like, Man, come on now.
You know, I got to say, Double A, these are the times when I wish some private investor, some guy with one of the 1% would be like, hey, you know what?
Send my plane over there.
I got you guys.
Pick up those people.
Or not even that, but hey, Southwest, I'll pick up that tab. You know what I mean? So,
man, it's like fucking shitty. I'm like, come on, man, $20?
Yeah.
Like, man, these people have just lost everything. Like,
seriously, fucking bananas. I had not heard that.
The death climb is like past 53 right now, so... Yeah, I mean, it's terrible what's going on over there.
Yeah, super crazy. Again, I hate to lead off with deaths, but I was like, I think you said that there was a musical passing.
Yeah, Robertson from the band. You know, they were called the band because that's how fucking good they were. That they were just called
the band. Damn, yeah. You're the band.
I think most people know The Weight. Yes. They probably would know that one song out of all the songs of the whole catalog. And so it was a you know, it's just, again, it's that decade where we're going to be losing people.
Yeah.
You know, he was 80 years old and, you know, it's getting up there. And then after he left the band, he worked very closely with Martin Scorsese.
Oh, really?
Yeah. He did a lot of the music work, or he was like the music supervisor for like a lot of Scorsese's movies, like a lot.
Oh, cool.
Like really big ones like Goodfellas, Casino, Wolf of Wall Street. Like he worked with Scorsese almost all the way to his last movie. So,
and that's awesome.
They became real friendly because Martin Scorsese directed The Last Waltz, and they really became good friends from that meeting in 1976. And that relationship that's lasted that long. So,
and The Last Waltz is like a documentary about them?
Yes,
a live concert type
thing. It's a live concert, and it pretty much set the benchmark for concerts being filmed. I mean, that's a beautiful like concert film.
Yeah. Right?
Scorsese does it great. Like, it's clear.
Okay.
He gets some really good shots in. I mean, man, it's just
nice.
This is a great concert. Great
from back in the 70s.
76. Yeah.
Cool. Very cool.
I mean, they're one of those 60s bands that, you know, played with Bob Dylan, you know, played at Woodstock, played at all those big festivals in the 60s. I mean, they were everywhere, you know, at one point. So,
well, you know, again, thoughts and prayers to his, you know, family and his fans, obviously, a guy that was a huge musical influence. So, always sad, you know. 80 is a good long life.
And then I don't know if my brother ever played you Rodriguez's CDs.
Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah.
He passed away.
Really?
He passed away earlier in the week, too.
Wow.
Yeah. So, and there's a really great documentary on him called Searching for Sugar Man.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. And basically, you know, he was like a folk artist, too, in the 60s, but his albums flopped terribly here. Like, nothing. Apparently in South Africa, though, he's like just as big as what Elvis would be here, or like the Beatles. Like in South Africa, he's a legend. His songs are anthems over there in South Africa. And he did not know this.
Wow.
You know, but like he's like one of the biggest selling artists over there on the other side of the world. So
it's always insane, right, Double A? Like how, you know, music will resonate in like one area of the world so much more. You know what I mean? I know jokingly we always bring up like Hasselhoff in Germany.
Yeah.
But he says, I mean, his name sounds German. You know what I mean? Yeah. And I'm like, hey, you know, great. I mean, it's a kind of a joke here, right? David Hasselhoff music.
Yeah, it's a joke here. But I mean, at one time, you got to remember that dude was shit hot too. I mean, Knight Rider and Baywatch. I mean, man, that dude was like big time. And over here,
but good for him. I mean, I would feel successful as a musician if I had success in one part of the country.
Like, big time. When you can rank just as much as everybody else in one part of the country.
I remember there was these t-shirts that people were wearing for a while. Maybe it was a reference to something. If it was, I don't know, but it would just said big in Japan, which I always thought was cool.
Yeah.
It's like,
because everyone's big in Japan.
I'm big in Japan.
Everyone's big over there.
What else, Double A?
Today is Jim Lee's birthday.
Happy birthday, so, Jim Lee. I mean, thank you for everything.
Yeah, I mean, if you're, you know, growing up in the 90s, Jim Lee shit was everywhere. X-Men issue 1, you know, the highest selling comic ever. Over 8 million copies of X-Men issue 1 sold. I mean, the X-Men animated series is based on his designs.
Yeah.
I mean,
yes.
And then, you know, the Batman Hush story that he kind of reinvigorated Batman again.
Yeah.
Then he did the Superman story, which his Superman looks fucking great.
Which is neat because he wrote with Richard Donner.
Yeah.
Richard Donner is the writer on that story, which is cool.
And then the Hush one is written by Jeff Loeb. So that's cool too. Yeah, you know,
I mean, everyone, I mean, you get a chess work with Jim Lee, you do it.
You just put his name in his fucking comic cell.
I think, Ian, you have said this before, but it's like you look at his art from like back, you know, in the maybe, you know,
late
80s, and it was still very, very, very good, but he just got better, like better and better.
I mean, man, his X-Men shit is just so fucking great to look at.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's beautiful. You know, his Superman, his Batman, his Nightwing. I mean, I don't know what the dude does, but man, that dude is just like, I love his depictions of people, of different characters.
And he's a guy that kind of can do both, right? Like, it's like his women are beautiful and his guys are also like, you know, hunky and superhero looking, you know what I mean? It's like he gets it both. You
his know Magneto mean? Is like the best depiction of Magneto I've ever seen.
Yeah. Where his age is kind of ambiguous, you know what I mean? And he looks like this.
He looks strapping, like in the 50s, but like a young, like in shape.
Powerful.
Dude. Yeah.
For sure. Yeah.
Like, yeah. Yeah, like almost thing like I guess like a what Hulk Hogan, you know?
Yeah,
how big he was like in his 40s, 50s, you know? I mean, you know,
he does a
great Wolverine.
Yeah, he does a great Wolverine. Man. Yeah, absolutely. Man,
killer Wolverine. I mean, he's back there. I got his drawing back there. and there's his Superman.
Yeah, like, we love that one. Yeah. The Blue Beetle come out today, Double A?
I think it. I thought it was next week.
Maybe next week. Okay, I thought it was.
And that's a kind of a shame too. So again, that's been written off as not part of James Gunn's lineup. And right now, the box office projections are like at 17 to 30 million. I'm like, man, that's
low.
Whew, man, DC is just getting their fucking ass kicked real bad. I mean, Flash with 55, this one maybe 30 million. I'm like, damn. Like,
I mean, do you think at this point, Double A, should Gunn just scrap everything?
No, I think they're putting too much money into his. Superman's got to come out. Superman's got to be the guy to carry DC again.
But why not put everything to bed and wait and focus on that and focus on making and putting out one good movie?
Yeah, especially, you know, with the fucking, you know, the Flash. I mean, just how bad, you know, we love the movie. Oh, we thought it was a good movie. If you get a chance to check it out, check it out.
I already pre-ordered.
The disastrous reception of the Flash.
Yeah.
Just, man, I'm like, man, that's one of the seven, you know, that's one of the Justice League. That's one of their big, big guns. And man, for that movie to fucking crash like the way it did, it's just not good.
Yeah. Yeah, Friday Night or Holty Bear told me, he was like, hey, did you order the digital? I guess he does the digital cop. The digital is now his. And he goes, dude, I've been watching the shit out of that movie.
It's a good movie. It's real entertaining. Yeah. I think what it is, again, is that Gunn keeps coming out and keeps saying this is not part of my DCU. So it's kind of like, well, why the fuck should we watch this
movie? Right, right.
And it's kind of like, damn, you know, like.
He's not doing his own product any favors for sure. Bush 18 says, hey, what's up, Bush 18? Is that Rosie the robot? Oh no, that's a different robot. My bad. I thought that was Rosie from the Jetsons. I was like, damn, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Facebook user says, best part of the Flash was Keaton's Diamond, hands down.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Michael Keaton just reminded everyone again that he was just the best.
Yeah. No, I agree. And I mean, I think for some people, if you were even a child of a child of that generation of that, the Keaton Batman, but you started to literally like the Bale Batman, this really still put him over the top for you.
And see, that's the thing. Like, Bale was always kind of hard to get into. Like, I love the aggressive style that Nolan brought to Batman, but you know, his Bruce Wayne was kind of iffy, and you know, the voice is always just a real bad voice, you know. And I love Christian Bale. I love that fucking deal. I love him in The Fighter, American Psycho, Equilibrium. Love Christian Bale. You know, I mean, he's just a really good actor. It's just, I don't know, he just couldn't get the Batman part down, you know?
Yeah. This Facebook user says, yo, 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 Facebook user, please identify yourself. I don't know. Was that Jerry? Is that you? Might be Joe. Guys, if you don't know, we will let you know right here that we are already live. But before leaving a comment, please grant StreamYard permission to see your name at StreamYard.com/Facebook. This will let us see your Facebook profile picture.
And that's it.
Or if that's not your cup of tea, go to YouTube. And if you have a YouTube account, we'll see everything there through YouTube. I mean, we don't care how you watch, as long as you're watching and joining the conversation with us. So no complaints, but just saying we want to give credit to whoever's talking to and call you by name and you know, address your comments fairly. So let's see. It says, you can't guess who it is with the yo-yo-yo. Shit, I don't know. That's tough, man. I'm off the sauce right now. I'm drinking Red Bull right here. I'm getting the damn jitters.
It's like CM said, Fridays are just not good for us.
And not only that, but we're roasting in this fucking sun, right? Double A. It's like, I saw this meme. It said, I apologize for what I said when it was 109 the other day.
Yes, even they kind of go back to the James Gunn, you know. Now, you know, Gal Gadot was saying, like, all right, Wonder Woman 3 is back.
I know.
And then Gunn was like, kind of like, it's not going to be part of the DCU. It's kind of like, fuck.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's always been the problem with DC, from the comics to the shows to the movies. That's always their fucking thing, that they never just want to connect.
Yeah. And again,
how can you replace her? She's been so good as Wonder Woman.
I don't want to blame James Gunn, but I really feel like there's too many hands in that cookie jar. And it's like,
Do you have control, or do you not? They probably say, okay, you're going to be the one you're in charge. You're going to be answering the questions, but Warner Brothers is still going to be making the major decisions.
Yeah. And I got to say, AA, I feel like, not to interrupt you, real quick, just that I've been seeing people after Secret Invasion coming after Kevin Feige now, saying that he's lost it.
And you know what? It's like I said, he's not going to give us X-Men right away. He's not going to give us Fantastic Four. You know what I mean? He's giving us stuff to kind of just keep us.
Mm-hmm.
Keep us here. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I mean, we just got to wait for the major movies. Like, right now, Loki's gearing up to go pretty soon. You know? Yeah. So, I mean, and that might lead to a movie. So, I mean, which I'm very excited. I'm very excited about Loki coming back.
I can't wait either. And again, though, maybe it is like Iger said. Maybe it's like there's too much content. And
maybe there is.
You're spoiled.
You're giving us too much shit that, you know, a lot of people really don't want to see. You know what I mean?
Remember when we had to wait for a movie, a sequel? We had to wait. You know what I mean? Really wait. And now look at us. This strike's going on.
That's a good one. We've got to wait. The writer's strike isn't helping. Yes, that's true.
Very true. This is a user says they saw that the best parts. Godot was one of the best parts of the Snyderverse. Yeah, don't disagree with you there. Yeah. I agree. I love her. It says here,
I'm all in for season two of Loki.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, and Facebook user, please tell us who you are. Is that Joe? Is that you? I don't want to guess incorrectly, but yeah.
And look, like I said, we've seen the shows and we like them. But again, if you're asking me and Sam, what shows would you like to see between the movies? A lot of those names wouldn't be our first answer at all.
No, they wouldn't.
Secret Invasion storyline wouldn't be our first answer. Yeah. You know, the Falcon and Winter Soldier wouldn't be one.
No.
Moon Knight probably wouldn't be none. It wouldn't come out of our lips, honestly. Mm-hmm. You know,
As much as I thoroughly enjoyed Hawkeye, it's like not really one of my first. Like
when we're thinking Wolverine, Hulk, you know, I mean, you know, something, you know.
If you look at my wall of, you know, collected action figures, the people I have up there are like Superman, Nightwing, Wolverine, you know, Doctor Doom, you know, Namor, but that was because of recently, you know what I mean? You know, did I say Spider-Man already? There's a lot of Spider-Man out there.
But even then, like Doctor Doom, like that'd be so cool if they did like a six
Silver Surfer. Silver Surfer. A story set in space. You know what I mean? Like, I think if they did a Silver Surfer, like Doctor Strange, I got Doctor Strange.
And like you said, we seen them and we liked them. We liked what we saw, you know, and we covered a lot of them here, but it's just like I said, they wouldn't be the first names off our list.
No, not at all. Yeah.
I love the Secret Invasion storyline, but it was too small and didn't tease the paranoia enough.
Agreed. I think this is Jerry.
Yeah, and then right here it is for sure.
Cyclops for Life. Definitely that's Jerry. Yeah, and Jerry with the yo-yo-yo. Now I remember. Sorry, Jerry. I am. I don't know how hot it is up there in Fort Worth, but it's super hot here in San Antonio. I mean, just the walk from AA's car to inside the house is like, oh my gosh. And I filmed it for this guy who's actually out in the heat for his job. By the way, AA, since Jerry is here, I have to have a conversation with you about scheduling some episodes to record with Jerry D for Totally Rad Christmas. He has reminded me if I could please have that talk with you. Guys, if you don't know, Jerry D is one of the greatest Christmas podcast hosts there is out there, and he is by far the best Christmas podcast host about Christmas in the 80s.
Okay.
Christmas in the 80s, no doubt. I won't make any enemies. We got
too many friends.
If you got an opportunity to, and you love Christmas and you love the 80s, Totally Rad Christmas is the show for you. So please go check it out. And AA, we have to get these on the books with Jerry. He said he will work with our schedules because he's going to get into his busy season pretty soon and he won't be able to record. So, yes. See, Jerry, on air, you saw me do it live. Do it live. Had to get that out there. You guessed it. No worries, Joe. It's baking there. Yeah, definitely. I know half the time my girlfriend's talking to me in the car, and I'm like, I'm waiting for the car to cool off. I cannot think right now. Like, don't talk to me in this heat. So, yeah. What else, AA? Were there other things?
Yeah, we got like two local events happening tomorrow. Yes. Well, one is this whole weekend. Mm-hmm. Tomorrow is the Ekman Comic Show here in San Antonio, up 1604 and 281. You know, that's a great show. That really is. From like,
we've been going for years,
you know, or decades almost.
Yeah, by this point. Yeah. Way to date ourselves. But
great show. It's a great comic book show. You know, they got a lot of cool vendors and shit like that. So, and then Traders Village, they're having kind of like a blood in, blood out kind of like.
Is that right?
And the one who
Damian played, Chapa.
Yeah, he's the one that played the white one.
Yeah, and he was also Ken in Street Fighter, right?
Yes.
Damian Chapa.
And then the other one that
Rolling Oaks.
Victor.
From Blood
I'm Blood sorry, Out. Yeah, but it's Blood in, Blood Out. So if you ask me about American Me, I can probably name off American Me.
I'd probably
Blood
more in, with Blood that one too.
I'm not really big on, but I know for San Antonio, people love Blood in, Blood Out.
So. We leave Blood in, Blood Out to the Now Watch This Podcast. That's their cup of tea.
But they're going
to
be at Trader Village. Authorities. I mean, yeah, Jesse Borrego is usually there too.
Yeah.
They haven't announced if he's going to be there, but I mean, I wouldn't see why he wouldn't go. That's a perfect.
Give him a call.
Yeah.
So unless he's out doing something, you know what I mean? It's so funny. My girlfriend watches a lot of crummy horror, you know what I mean? Yeah. And really crummy. And the other day she was watching one, he was in it or whatever. But because she watches that, I got to see that CM Punk movie that was his horror movie. So and I was like, it was not good.
Oh, shit.
It was not good. I mean, he wasn't terrible, but he wasn't.
But he's not an actor. He's a wrestler.
Yes, exactly. Yes. Although I heard he's good in heels.
Yeah,
which that's playing a wrestler. Yeah, not a lot of stretch there, but but guys, and this is cool because I think this will be Dale Ekman's first show, right? Double A since he's become a shop owner, right?
Yeah,
he's now has a brick and mortar shop. Right.
Yes, yes.
Which we haven't made our way out to yet to check out. Are you going to try to go to Ekman's tomorrow or no?
Yes, I want to.
Okay, I'm going to try to go too because my nephew really wants to go.
Okay, cool.
So I want to try to go to Ekman's too. And it's just it's a really fun show. It's actually at the Shriners.
Even if I don't buy anything, I just kind of want to go and see it.
It's fun. Sometimes
Rick's going
to
be there.
Yeah, we get to see people we know. Rick Nas might be there. You know what I mean?
Alfred's going to be there for sure.
Definitely Alfred, and he has some really cool stuff. He's going to be showing our good friend Alfred at Collectors Cove and the Collectors Cove Corpse. Guys, give them a like, follow, share if you want to. He was just showing all the villain covers, the Alex Ross Timeless covers. And I was like, man, those just look so damn badass, right? Double A. And he's got some cool, he's always got what people are talking about now. He's got Miles and Gwen stuff, which is super hot. Mm-hmm.
Maximum Carnage stuff, some Spider-Man 90s stuff, pretty good pricing. Because some of them have pricing, and I think he told you that some of the Timeless are going to go between 10 and 15.
Mm-hmm.
But some of the Timeless villains, it's Phoenix, Dark Phoenix. It's King, Apokolips, Juggernaut.
He said some would be as low as 8, too. Yeah, the Doctor Doom. The Kingpin one looks badass, where he's almost the whole cover.
I'm not too sure if Annihilus was part of this one or not.
Yes, I am, yeah.
Yeah, but the King one looks awesome. That always looks fun. I mean, Alex Ross just depicts these characters so fucking great. You think they look awesome before, and then he just he upgrades it so much, and you're even the sorriest villain looks you want to buy.
you want to buy
a picture definitely. From Alex Ross drawing him,
definitely. Dormammu, he's got Dormammu.
Yeah, Dormammu, yeah.
And Jason Weird, your picture was showing earlier, but then now it's
yeah,
not.
Now it's not. But I knew it was EJ.
Yeah, that's the weekend news for you, but I would suggest highly, Jason, go check out Ekman's show. Yeah. It's a great show. Again, the Shrine Auditorium.
Shrine Auditorium, yes.
Here in San Antonio, Texas. Yes.
You go up to 81 all the way to 1604, go 1604 west. And it'll be the Blanco exit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So. It's right off the access road. So, always a fun time there. Yeah. I'm looking forward to going and checking out Alfred's stuff and Rick's stuff and all of our buds that we get to see when we go out there.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else, Double A, that stood out to you in the world of news, pop culture? We got football coming soon. Preseason's going, right?
Preseason tomorrow. The Cowboys, I think, are playing the first time against Jacksonville.
Okay.
And I think we already had a few games already.
I think there's some games tonight.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Friday Nighter Jeremy was telling me that there was going to be some games tonight. So.
And then the NBA Hall of Fame is this weekend. And again, if you're a San Antonio Spurs fan, this is the one for you. This is the one that Popovich is going to be in, Becky Hammon's going to be in, and Tony Parker is going
to
be in.
Congratulations to those three San Antonio legends.
And NBA legends.
And NBA basketball legends. WNBA and NBA. But we love Coach Pop. Parker, we would not have maybe all the titles we have without him. Becky Hammon.
And then she killed it in her first year as a WNBA coach. She won a title.
Yeah. And obviously, a huge part of our
superstars.
The Silver Stars, the Spurs coaching staff, you know what I mean? And it was always really cool and exciting to see her there. And wow, there's this really knowledgeable, female coach, athlete. Yeah, there, and we're an organization that was giving her that chance. So that's really badass. So, man, congratulations to them.
Yeah, so man, Spurs Hall of Fame. So that's awesome. Yeah.
There's something that I hadn't said, Dolly, that I have been wanting to say, but I didn't want to say it and speak out of turn. I knew what happened, but it really wasn't like, you know, he hadn't made it public yet, or whatever. But our good friend, Lucky the Dork Dad, over at the Now Watch This podcast, you know, he lost a family member, his brother. He talked about it openly on his show. And I just wanted to send our condolences. Obviously, we're thinking of you, brother. Didn't want to say it when it happened, when we knew off air. But now that we do know, we went wide, know that we're thinking of you and your family and our thoughts and prayers. But Lucky's a great, great guy, man. He's, you know, giving my nephew free action figures, you know, and just, you know, the same thing like our good buddy, you know, Zach at Collecting Weekly has done too. And obviously, you know, him, if you saw their episode of After Dark, I mean, just truly heart-wrenching. But, you know, also amazing, AA, to show bravery, courage to go out there and talk about it. Anytime these guys talk about something on a podcast, I'm amazed. I mean, you know, like I would say when it comes to our private lives, we both kind of keep that off our bar shows. Not to say that I wouldn't talk about it. No, you know what I mean? But I mean, guys, you know, applause, my hat's off to you guys.
And I'm sorry, guys, for, you know, your losses, both of you.
Yeah, it's seriously. Just terrible. It's terrible. Really is. And like I said, Zach really poured his heart out, man. And it was beautiful too, because he had, you know, three other guests on there, and you know, they were all equally showing emotion. And you know, a lot of times men get a bad rap for pushing shit down and not being able to do that stuff. And man, here is an example of yeah. I mean, you know, I think in the past I've been guilty of it too. I mean, like, you know, I mean, sometimes it just comes out. You know what I mean? Maybe
sometimes
that's,
you just need to talk about it, honestly. I'm being very honest with you. Sometimes you just need to talk about it.
Absolutely, you do. And you know, guys, I'm always here for any one of you guys that ever wants to talk. Reach out to me through any type of messaging or whatever. And you know, or if you have my number, call me or message me on Facebook. I definitely don't want anyone to be struggling. And we're both big proponents for mental health.
Big time.
And having
like a bro. Like I said, talk about it.
Yeah.
Trust me.
Yeah. So we love you guys. And again, your guys are all in our thoughts and prayers for sure. I kind of had a weird week, AA, real quick. I just want to talk about it. It was interesting and weird in the sense that I watched some cool stuff. I hadn't rewatched any X-Men episodes from the old
90s
cartoon, but I just felt like ever since you had mentioned it a couple episodes back about the High Evolutionary episode, I was like, man, I really want to watch it. You know what I mean? And so I was like looking for it. I watched it. It was like, you know, great. I was like, oh man, that Family Ties episode is so cool with Wanda and Wonder Gore.
And you kind of missed that High Evolutionary, right?
Yes.
Like, man, you're like, man, that's the one I wanted.
Yeah. You know? And my nephew kind of watched with me. So he was like, oh, that's him or whatever. And he was like, man, it's cool. And the reason
he looked cooler.
He looked way cooler. And the other reason is that like I've had this stack of like figures that I had doubles of that I've been planning to open, like if me and him continue to do our little like unboxing show. Yeah, the monkey and the Yankee. But you know, he's doing his own thing now on TikTok. I said, that's cool. You go, you know what? Yeah. He's doing some really cool stop motion. Okay. I gotta show you his little stop motion videos are really cool. And you know, before all this, you know, happened with Zach, I mean, we got the pleasure of going to visit him at his house, and Zach was very, very gracious with him. And, you know, like I said, gave him some really cool parting gifts. And we bought even a figure that my nephew was just like so in love with that Zach was like, you like this? He's like, I'll give you a good price. And so, you know, huge markdown on that. And it was just out of pure, just like a kid wants to play with it. And he's been making videos with them and they're really cool. And it's funny because Zach was telling me, he's like, oh, I saw your nephew's videos. They're funny. He's like, I'm going to subscribe to him. So he did. And that was like a huge deal to him, you know. But anyway, so he was kind of watching me and he was like, well, he was like, you know, like, what figures do you have to open? So we know it's his last week before school goes back. So I was like, fuck it, I'll just open these with him. So we opened that one. We opened a Boba Fett. And we were just like opening them, posing them and stuff. Yeah, but we opened the same High Evolutionary that you have. I have one too, whatever. And I was like, yeah, fuck it, we'll open it. And I was like, damn, I really want to see that cartoon. So I watched that. And then I'm talking to my sister, right, about stuff she's watching or whatever. And like out of nowhere, she's like, I said, what are you watching? She's like, I'm watching The Godfather. And I was like, what?
Whoa.
And then I said, why are you watching that? She's like, she's like, I always wanted to see it, but you know, she's like, and I said, what? I said, fuck, you always make me watch shit that like we've seen a thousand times. The other day we watched Mrs. Doubtfire. Love Mrs. Doubtfire, but I've seen it a bazillion times. And I was like, damn, why'd you tell me? I want to watch Godfather with you. She's like, I was just like, you know, watching it or whatever, you know what I mean? And so I was like, okay. So I was like, I was like, she finished it in one day and then she wanted to watch part two in the same day. And I was like, all right. So I got to watch a big chunk of part two with her.
Yeah.
But I wanted to ask your opinion, AA. Should I just make her watch regular part three or should she do the coda, the death of Michael Coda?
I've seen both. And you know, I want to like Godfather 3. I really do. And I've seen it like about five or six times and I just, man, I just can't get into it.
Even Coda doesn't do it
for you. Yeah, I just can't get into it, man. I'm just, man. I like Andy Garcia's performance. I like Al Pacino's performance.
Yeah.
But, man, it's just, it's not even a good gangster movie. Like on its own, it's not even like a really good gangster movie. I thought
Coda was a little bit more coherent.
Okay.
But I mean, you know, again, and it's funny because everyone loves that, you know, like every time I went out, they pull me back in.
Say that fucking line over and
over. That's like one of the famous lines. I'm like, that's.
And it's funny too, because like he yells at Andy Garcia, like, shut up. It's funny. It's funny.
Yeah.
I love that part. Yeah.
You know, and it's like Andy Garcia is like Sonny Corleone's son.
So I really do like his portrayal because he's supposed to be like James Caan's character, and I think he pulls that off
really well. I thought so too.
Yeah. And like I said, I have no problem with Andy Garcia's performance, but
man, I thought Sofia Coppola was really great too.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I mean, for what she was, I mean, I guess it was. Yeah,
yeah, Jerry, we can see you now, Jerry.
Look at that lovely guy right there. Christmas tree in the back right there.
Like I said, I try liking. I know Amy's probably going to want to see it just to finish it and, you know, see it, watch it.
You know, she shocks me all the time because sometimes she'll be like, oh, I like that one or whatever. You know what I mean? I'm like, oh. She likes the first Suicide Squad.
And cool. And like I said, I've tried seeing it like without the blinders. Like, okay, forget about Godfather 1 and 2. Let me just see this like as a crime movie.
Yeah.
You know? And I can't get into it.
No, it's not one you revisit.
Yeah, and the whole church storyline too, you know.
Yeah.
That's kind of like something too. I'm like, you know.
It's just not as good. Like
Godfather
ones.
1 and 2 are just so fucking good. Like those movies are really, really good. Even my wife, who's not a big fan of those kind of movies, she's seen 1 and 2 and she enjoys them. Like she really loves those movies.
Yeah. Like, no need to apologize, Jared. It's all good, man. I'm glad you got
it. Like I've always told like CMN people, I'm like, man, it's amazing that Robert De Niro, he wins his first Academy Award on Godfather 2 and he's speaking almost all Italian.
Yeah.
I mean, that's true. Yeah. That's amazing.
And I was telling my sister, I was like, that one is my favorite one because of that. I love the Vito story.
I always have trouble too because, like, man, I'll see Godfather 1, I'm like, man, that was so fucking badass. And Marlon Brando just kicks ass. Oh, yeah, and then I see part 2 and Pacino's performance is like so much more better in Godfather Part 2. Not saying he wasn't great in Part 1, but man, he fucking kills it in Part 2. And then the prequel story, it's just like, damn, like, that's a great fucking origin story too.
Uh-huh.
Like my wife loves it when he goes to the room, when he goes to New York, Vito.
Yeah.
When he's immigrating to the United States he starts singing. Like, she loves that part. Like, it just blows her mind, man.
Yeah.
You know, there was shit like that.
Double A, I got to tell you something that was really fun. I got to watch my sister's reaction to, I should have fucking TikToked it, but to that part, you know, in Part 2 where Kate's telling him about
the baby.
And I was like, well, I got to see what she's going to react. And her eyes just got big and she was like, oh man, that fucking bitch. She hates Kate too. She was like, and when she talked to me about Apollonia, she's like, bro, I couldn't believe when his Italian wife.
Man, that was brutal, right?
I said, that was my favorite of Michael's ladies or whatever. And I was just like, but yeah, when she saw, she was like, man, this bitch wants to die. And I was like, I'm telling you. I was like, how she lived, I do not know.
And I tell people too, and I think it's like a code of theirs. Like they don't kill women.
Right. Yeah.
But you know, I tell people too, man, there's no actor that could touch Pacino in the 70s. Like, man, he can do so much acting with his eyes, his body language. Mm-hmm. You know, when he spoke softly, yes. I mean, man, like no one can touch that dude in the 70s. That dude in the 70s is fucking insanely good.
That's a great perspective. Yeah. That's a really great take. Yeah.
Just great, great stuff that Pacino does.
Jeremy in the house says, hey, what's up, Jeremy? Appreciate you being here, brother. Jeremy says he's going to be watching some football tonight, but he'll have us on in the background. So that's I told him about a little bit about what the story was about. And he's like, oh, that sounds really cool. So yeah, I hope you'll listen in, Jeremy.
Yeah. And, you know, we told Marquise too about this story and he was like, really up for it too. So
Jerry says, great saga. Agree, Jerry. Can't argue.
And you know what? I really liked where they're going when they're talking about Part 4.
Mm-hmm.
It was going to be the downfall of, man, I forgot his name. What's Andy Garcia's character's name?
Oh, shoot, I forgot his name too.
Okay, well, Anthony? Andy Garcia.
Anthony? No, he's not Anthony.
No, so it was going to be like his downfall. It was going to be, he was going to be running the Corleone family. But he was going to take it to the drugs, mm-hmm. the drug racket,
okay.
which they had avoided since like the 40s.
Yeah.
They had avoided that. And it was going to be kind of like his end. At the same time, they're going to be showing Sonny coming up. It was going to be kind of like his prequel story with Fredo and Michael.
Interesting.
And, you know, them growing up. But it was going to focus on Sonny.
And Coppola was writing this with
Puzo, yeah, right? Yeah. Him and Puzo.
But he stopped when he died.
Yeah. And then, you know, they just never revisit. But I was kind of like, man, part four kind of sounded amazing.
Yeah, I was going to say, that does sound really good.
Really kind of cool to, you know, to take that Corleone family and take it into an area they never wanted.
Yeah.
I was like, oof.
Yeah. Interesting. But yeah, so she was watching that. I just thought that was cool. And she's also started what we do in the shadows. So she's watching her way through that as well.
Oh, real quick too, Reservation Dogs, season 3, episode 3. I would recommend that episode to anyone. I don't think you even have to see the entire series. Mm-hmm. That's just a really good episode. Like, me and my wife were like blown away by the episode. It's super deep.
Okay.
It's kind of like based on a true incident. So it's kind of like, damn, it's brutal and kind of like an ugly look at kind of like early American history.
Yeah.
So it's,
you got me wanting to watch it real bad.
And like I said, you really don't have to see, I don't think you have to see any of the past two seasons for it. It's season 3, episode 3.
But I, what
if you got Hulu? It's on Hulu.
Double, what are those, 22 minutes?
22 minutes? Yeah.
So, guys, if you go back to the old Now Watch This podcast, our friends, our, as we say, our pod sons, they a huge fan of this show, the guy that got me to watch it, was Lucky the Dork Dad. Lucky was saying back in the law, he would always be asking Joe, like, have you seen Reservation Dogs? He's like, and he, before it came out, he's like, it looks like it's going to be funny. It looks like it's going to be good. He likes comedy stuff.
And it's kind of, it's a comedy, but...
There's some definitely serious, some
really heavy issues.
Yeah, there is.
Yeah.
But
it's a really good show. It's called Reservation Dogs.
And you're caught up, right? You watched all season one.
Mm-hmm. Now I'm on season 3. I'm on the current.
So I've seen season 1 and season 2. I need to rewatch a little bit of the end of season 2 so I can start season 3. But I didn't know Double A was gonna start watching it. So I was like, oh dude, now you've got me pumped to get back into it or whatever. But yeah, it's a really fun show, funny, of, good it's characters.
Co-created by Taika.
Like Waititi. Yeah. I was like, oh, yeah. Shit. And it takes place on a Native American reservation in Oklahoma. And again, the four characters.
It's all like a Native American cast. So.
Yeah. Yeah, it is. And they're like a little bit of like Goonies vibe with like, you know, like where it's a what are they? Teens? Though?
Yes.
Teen kids, you know, kind of like, around.
Kind of like Indian, kind of like legends. Mm-hmm. Folklore, mm-hmm. kind of shit like that, kind of thrown into, like the spirits, you know, and the owls, like the owl. I don't know what that symbolizes, but every time they show an owl, the eyes are blurred out. I don't know what that is.
Mm, interesting.
Yeah. To Indians.
Okay. I don't think I picked that up.
Yeah. Every time they show an owl, the eyes are blurred out. So I was like, oh shit.
Very interesting. Quick throw up right there from our website, guys. Let me talk real quickly about the contest that's going on with Collecting Weekly. If you guys don't know, I believe that's still going on as they race towards the 3,000 subscribers mark on their YouTube channel. They're giving away and guys, go check them out if you want to go, you know, get all this information. There's no links to click on, but you can win a Carnage Hot Toys figure. It's really, really amazing looking. We can't say that, stress that enough, whatever. I will put the link up right here if you want to like write it down or type it in while you're listening. I highly suggest going to that and putting yourself in an opportunity to win. Jeremy, if you're listening, do it. Jerry, if you're doing it, do it. It's going to be a worthwhile thing to win should you win it. And all you got to do is like a couple of pages and subscribe to a couple of channels, whatever. And I think you get a bonus entry if you use a passcode. We'll give you a passcode for tonight. We'll just call it, what do you think, Double A? Superman?
Superman.
Yeah. There you go. Superman. So go pop that in, whatever, for an extra bonus entry. But yeah, it's really, really rad looking. And again, if you check out Collecting Weekly, give them a follow. You can see the figure and see the contest. They have it pinned at the top of their stuff. So you can check it out. So go do so. But yeah, what else? Double A, Reservation Dogs. Definitely cool.
There we go. Jeremy says, here owls represent spirits and or messengers. Mm. Okay. Well, for what, again, you know, they have them blurred out. So, you know, it's not your TV or anything fucked up. It's on the show. So,
you know, it's funny. My mom used to collect owls because she's like you from the Highland High School, the Highland Owls. Yeah. So she used to have like, my house was like full of owls or whatever. And then she said she stopped collecting them because she learned that they were a bad omen. They meant that someone was going to die. Shit. Okay. So, yeah, I was like, oh, shit. You know what I mean? So,
all right.
Leave it to mom to be like, no shit. You know, like,
Get on her though.
Yeah. Anything else, Double A, you feel that we should address? I don't think there was anything else that was like major that I was thinking about.
No, I mean, The Witcher finished.
Yeah, The Witcher finished. Well, I don't think we'll talk about that in a whole episode because it was
The last three episodes aired. There is a Johnny Manziel, in case any of you guys are fans of Johnny Manziel documentary on Netflix.
Okay.
That says it goes into a lot of deep shit.
The money?
Yeah.
Yeah, wow. Threw it all away. Literally threw it. Let's see here. This son, someone put the eggplant for there. Estonian cheese? I don't know. I can't tell what that is, but I see the eggplant and the little boom, so that's kind of sexual there. But if you're watching, we appreciate it. So Double A. I think without further ado, we should get down to brass tacks with this one. What do you think?
Yeah.
All right, guys. It's been a while. I'm excited because it's been a while. And I love when Double A picks a comic book because he says, real quick, Jeremy says, new Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Last Ronin game coming. Very cool. And it's funny you mentioned that, Jeremy, because I'm going to talk about it a little bit. But Jeremy, if you get $20 in your hands, maybe you just wait for Christmas or your birthday, this is out in hardcover on Amazon for $20. It's a beautiful hardcover. All of the issues. And because we're talking comics, and because in our earliest episodes of Double A, when this was coming out, we talked about possibly covering this or whatever. And I think we just had so many other things to cover, we didn't get a chance to cover. That is not our subject tonight. Oh, we have some interesting comments here.
Yeah, Sonia says
totally disagree with that.
Says, Batman on top.
Well, you know, I would think Batman is a bottom, not a top, but
For us, we're not Batman fans.
That's just me, you know what I mean?
We are not Batman fans.
Jerry says, oh, nice, and Toy Mafia throws up the signs there, the alien and the peace symbols, so we appreciate that there, Toy Mafia. Yeah, Estonian and cheese, man, maybe that's Joe. Joe, are you under one of your false identities, Joe? I'm like, come on now. So, you know, here we go without burying the lead anymore. Guys, I got the shirt on here. And Double A, you know, again, I love when Double A gives me a comic book tree that I haven't read because it gives me a chance, A, to read comics, but B, you know, to, you know, deepen my knowledge of the lore and then talk about, you know, one of our favorite subjects of all when it comes to this, you know, maybe even Double A above TV and movies, you know what I mean? Our love for comic books. Yeah. So Jerry says, sounds like Joe. Joe, stop trolling under other identities. Damn it, Joe. Yeah. And Batman, he's all right. You know what I mean? So if it's Dick Grayson under the cowl, then I'm for it. But Double A, tell me a little bit about your background with this story and what made you want to read it and what made you want to tell me to read it so we can discuss it tonight.
Well, first off, it's an Elseworlds story. DC, that's pretty much their what if. And it's kind of like one of the first what if Superman had landed here instead of, you know, in Kansas. What if he landed somewhere else? So it's always cool. I've always liked those stories because writers kind of have more freedom to kind of do stuff, you know, and it's not going to be canon, so they can do a lot of stuff, and it's not going to hurt the character too much. This one, he lands on the planet Apokolips to be raised by Darkseid, and, you know, that's Darkseid, Superman, you know, together. That's a terrible duo together.
Oh, yeah.
So that's what intrigued me, and then I was like, man, you know, this story kind of sounds like the Superman animated series, the last two episodes. And so that really intrigued me, too. So I was kind of like, damn. And even the outfits kind of looked the same from the Superman cartoon to this one. So I was like, damn, you know, so I really intrigued me even more. And then I was like, you know what? I just need to pick up these three issues and I need to read it already because I can't find these in comic stores anywhere.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
How'd you end up finding them?
I had to just buy them on eBay.
Yeah. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. I had never heard of this story, and it's from 1998, correct?
1998.
I'd never heard of this, and I mean, I consider myself not an expert in Superman, but a Superman, you know, big time fan or whatever. And I was like, oh, you know, of all the Elseworlds stories that have been done, this is not one that I was familiar with. But I thought the concept sounded really cool. Of course, it's not the first time that I think that people have talked about, you know, like different, you know, paths Superman could have been on, you know.
And then, you know, this is the 85th year of Superman, and me and Sam are just big fans of Superman. So it's kind of like we wanted to do some Superman episodes.
Absolutely.
And, you know, we already covered, well, you know, one of his major storylines with Death and Family. It's like, let's do another one, you know?
Yeah, so, Death of Superman. No doubt. Yeah. Man. And I thought, again,
we want to do a few more episodes on Superman before the year's out.
I gotta say, though, I'm really surprised that the animation people, you know, who are doing great work for DC, the only place that's doing great things for DC, and maybe their TV stuff, because the Superman Lois show is fantastic.
Yeah.
I'm surprised they haven't picked this one up to do this. So this would be a great animated movie.
It would be cool. It would be really cool.
After I read it, I was like, oh my gosh, I would love, and I bet they would tweak it a little bit because
I would hope they would. I would hope they would keep the fourth world stuff
with that's it. What I was gonna say they would tweak, because that's what they tweaked in the Death of Superman.
But see, they did that though. They did tweak that out in the Superman animated series show.
Oh, for the Justice League.
They did kind of take that out. No, the Superman animated show. They took out the New Gods.
And put in who, the Justice League? Or?
No.
They just took them out.
It just took them out completely.
Oh, okay. Okay, interesting.
Yeah, so I mean, I was like, okay, you already did that. Kind of like make a movie where it's kind of like where it has all of them.
Yeah, and I wish, Lane Kramer was still here from earlier, who stated that this was his favorite Superman Elseworlds story, because I would love to hear from Lane.
And there's many more. Like, the Elseworlds are really good, interesting stories.
Yeah. So many good stories from there. Are they still doing Elseworlds?
I don't think they are.
The Black series now, right?
But I think Black took over. The Black Label took over for Vertigo.
Vertigo, okay.
Which I don't know why they even shut Vertigo down. That's
no kidding. Insane. That was like, again, their
best line.
Their best line, yeah. It was like when NXT was WWE's best or whatever. Yeah. It was like,
hey, speaking of NXT, Dirty Dom has been in NXT, and they've had some of their highest-rated shows.
There you go,
in like
man.
2 years.
Dude, so. Dom's holding it down.
Dom's fucking killing it.
Man. And I like Mommy. Yeah. Man, she's a Rhea Ripley, man. Yeah. I'm like, I just getting more and more of my crush going on her right there.
But, so. Man, you can't forget about Dom, though.
That's true.
He's a hard man.
Yeah, dang. Yeah, his real inspiration, Eddie. You know what I mean? Eddie Guerrero. Yeah, so AA, I was really glad you brought this to my attention. Really great story, interesting concept, and I was excited to read it. You know, you gave it to me last week, and I didn't know that we were going to make it an episode, you know what I mean, yet, but we talked earlier in the week, and you were like, well, you know, finish it up and tell me what you think. And I was like, yeah, dude, let's talk about it. That's great. Again, it gives me a chance to sit down and read comic books, and, you know, one of my favorite things to do. And again, this is a story that I wasn't familiar with, and it's Superman, so I love that. But yeah, let's get into it, AA. Yeah. So like we said, early on, we see, you know, the destruction of Krypton is going to happen. Classic Superman story that we know. He's going to get sent.
That third issue?
Yes. He's going to get sent to. We tilt them back a little bit. Tilt them back. There you go. Right there. That's a good image. Yeah. They're going to. And again, the imagery is just great. Who's the writer and artist, AA? The
writer is John Francis
Moore. Okay.
Huron Dyer and Hillary Barda.
Okay. That's the probably writer, artist, and inker, I'm assuming.
Inker, Hillary, yes.
Yeah, okay.
Yes. And it actually got word stories and pictures for both Huron and John Francis.
Okay, they probably worked together. Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's well drawn in that 90s style. You know what I mean?
Sometimes it kind of threw me off here and there. Like, I'm not a big fan of how he looks there.
Right. And again, you know? I was going to bring that up because I was like, there's parts where he does not look like.
Kind of an interesting blue costume here.
Yes. You know? And I liked when he finally started to kind of look more like the Superman that we know. Estonian Cheese is back. And he says, sup, I'm back. Okay, welcome back, Estonian Cheese.
So this is like the way Darkseid fits Superman with his armor.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was like, damn, that looks badass, you know?
Yeah, he gets him this armor because obviously since, you know, instead of getting, he does get sent to Earth, but gets intercepted by Darkseid,
he tells Metron, who is a fourth world god, to make sure he lands on Apokolips.
Yes. Yeah,
and if you're not too sure about Metron, he's a new guy that sits on the Mobius chair.
Mm.
The Mobius chair, if you're Batman fans, you know that's the chair he sat on.
Yes.
The Mobius chair,
right?
Which, you know, he asks, you know, what's Joker's real name? To which the Mobius chair tells him, "There's three Jokers."
Yeah, that's a very I thought was very cool. You know, that's some of the cool lore of the Batman stuff regarding, you know, the Joker. I always love when they make that story more rich, and that we've covered that comic book, Three Jokers, way back, right?
Yeah, it's been like when almost a year, 2 years, maybe, yeah, when that Three Jokers story.
But we love that story and how well it's drawn. You know, Jason Fabok actually, I think, follows us on Instagram.
Yes, he does. And, yes. Very cool. He's super cool. And man, his Batman is pretty damn killer. Jason Fabok. Man, he draws a fucking killer.
Dude, his Batgirl looked hot. Yeah. His Red Hood looked, you know,
like, if you guys don't know, like, you should really check his art.
And I loved the way he drew his Jokers.
Yeah, his Jokers were really good.
They looked different. And I commented on one of his pictures, and I said, this story is up there with other great Batman stories. You know what I mean? So, so obviously, like we said here, Kal-El's on his way to Krypton, gets intercepted by Darkseid.
He's on the way to Earth.
From Krypton, and gets intercepted, and then is raised on Apokolips. Now, they don't show us that, though. And I think that's what I was expecting. I think I was expecting to see, like, okay, here's Darkseid hardening him.
And there was a lot of room where I thought, man, you know, that would have really been cool for a whole first issue if they would have done that. So there is kind of like little things here and there that I was like, man, it kind of was a kind of like a missed opportunity. And I was kind of like, shit, you know, like, that's, I've told you, that's always what I wanted in a Silver Surfer story, was kind of to show him while he's in Galactus's service, like full-on villain, that full-on, you know, cosmic threat. I wanted to see that part.
Yes.
With it eventually reaching to Fantastic Four 48.
Yeah.
That's always been my kind of like my dream story. If somebody can just make that where he's like destroying planets left and right, you know. So
we should write a double.
Man, I would really love to.
Well, who do we get to draw?
Rizzo.
Yeah. I mean, you know, but and Rizzo, no disrespect, brother. But if we, but if we get like a Marvel guy, I mean, I would want, you know, one of the Q-Berts.
Yeah, if we're gonna do Q-Berts, I like Adam's stuff, but I have to go Andy. Andy.
Q-Bert. Okay, I'm fine.
I'd have to go with him.
I wonder if Jason Fabok has drawn from Marvel.
I don't think he has.
I would take him. You know what I mean? Who else do we like a lot? Double A.
That's the thing. I'm not really too caught up.
Yeah,
on the more modern artists now.
But I mean, I love like Humberto Ramos. You know what I mean? He's great. I don't know if he would draw how he would do with a Surfer story like that. I just want it to look so crispy.
That's me too.
I want it to look crispy if we did that.
Like story. I almost wanted like the John Buscema.
Oh yeah.
Run,
yeah
know,
yeah
like,
yeah.
Damn.
Yeah. Oh, that'd be incredible to make it look old school like that.
Yeah.
Because I have seen some modern iterations of the Surfer, and I'm kind of a little bit like, they kind of make him look like the old school. Yeah, they don't draw him big.
Buscema draw him big.
Yeah, they draw him more more lanky.
Lanky, yeah.
Now, you know, it's when we were talking about Surfer, right? Because one of the things that me and Double A discussed, and we had this discussion about after I read it, he was like, what'd you think? And I said, dude, it gave me heavy Galactus Surfer vibes. Yeah. And he was like, oh, I'm glad that you said that. He's like, I'm glad that you thought that. And I was like, yeah, which I liked because I was like, oh, damn, you know, you have Darkseid, who they make look badass in this book, I thought. I love him in that black armor. And, you know, I don't know that I've read a lot of, like, not that this is a Darkseid story, Double A, but where Darkseid is, like, the key primary antagonist. I don't know that I've read a lot of comic books where he's really, like, prominent in that, you know what I mean?
Okay.
And so it was cool for me to, like, see more of him and then to see, like, okay, like, you know, he is a strategist and he is, you know, but obviously this force to be reckoned with. So he was very like Galactus like to me in this, but without the like, you know, where Galactus is kind of just doing it because he wants the chaos.
Remember,
you know?
Like he's kind of like he is the model for Thanos.
Mm-hmm.
Darkseid is the model.
Yeah.
People have said that left and right. So yeah.
Yeah. And he's definitely villainous and he's definitely, you know, warmongering. Like he's, you know, all
he's the ultimate DC villain. When it comes down to it.
And I will say Double A, like it takes a little bit into the first issue. Well, for me, before like we get some Superman or whatever, he's not in there right away. We're getting a little bit of setup, right?
So it kind of does kind of like the New God stuff. If you know, this is like Kirby's characters, but you know, surrounding Superman, you know, the whole deal, CM is kind of like the peace between New Genesis and Apokolips is the trading of Scott Free, who's Mr. Miracle. Highfather gives Mr. Miracle to Darkseid. Darkseid gives Orion to Highfather.
Now, is that like how the original story goes?
Yes.
Okay. I wasn't familiar with.
So Orion is Darkseid's son. Mr. Miracle is Highfather's son.
Okay.
So in able to keep the peace between the two worlds, they trade their sons to each other. Now, obviously, where Orion's going to have a really badass life on New Genesis, he sends Mr. Miracle to Granny Goodness to be tortured and try to brainwash and all that kind of stuff to make him, you know, evil, you know?
So, Double A, these new gods were a part of the Jack Kirby drawn and written creation from back in when?
The 1970.
And they had their own run of books. So this is where these characters are established.
Yes.
And Darkseid is a new god?
Yes.
Okay, okay. Mm-hmm. But he's like, what, like the Hades of them? Or and my father is like the Zeus?
They're like almost brothers, yes.
Okay,
yes.
Okay. Yeah. And Orion would, I guess, be like one of Zeus's, or one of
sons. He'd like be like, I guess, Hercules if he sent him to...
Okay.
To hell, Hades.
And Orion, I'm a little bit familiar with because he is in DC
the
stuff.
Justice League cartoons, right. Superman animated that series.
Classic
cartoon.
Helmet or whatever. Yes. And then I always think about the scene from Kingdom Come where you think it's Darkseid.
And it's Orion. Him. Yeah. Yes. Where he looks full on Darkseid.
And they call him the ruler of the apocalypse. Ruler of apocalypse.
Yes. He takes over and he tries to make it better, but it's like, it's so fucking. Trash.
So is he one of these like anti-hero types?
It's just that he has Darkseid's blood in him. So Highfather can kind of calm him down, but it's just his blood just boils too much from him being Darkseid's son.
Gotcha.
You know, so he's always like, let's fight, you know, let's fight first, you know. And
okay,
you know, where Mr. Miracle is like Highfather, he's kind of like, you know, like let's hold up a bit, you know.
Yeah. And obviously we get like Desaad in this one.
Desaad is like his main torture.
Yeah.
How would you say that title? Like he's like his interrogator. He's a guy that tortures people for Darkseid.
I would say what the Grand Inquisitor was.
Yes, there you go.
Vader.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes,
so
perfect.
Is he the new God comics too?
Yes, he is.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So we're familiar with him because he's even in the Justice League movie. Mm-hmm. Now, what about it's Big Barda, right?
Big Barda. She is the what are they called? The flying. I forgot what Granny Goodness's group is called, but she is the leader of that group.
Yeah.
And she is at first a dedicated Apokolips warrior.
Yes.
Yes. In the original, in the current comics, outside of Elseworlds, her and Mr. Miracle are like one of those classic couples.
Okay.
You know, that, you know, we're still together and everything.
Oh, cool. Okay.
Yes. Yes. All right. She's a very strong warrior, very, very powerful. So,
okay.
In this one, though, she doesn't end up with Mr. Miracle.
No, she doesn't. You know? Yeah.
So that's kind of, that was interesting, too, that little twist they threw in.
Yeah. That threw me by the end because I was like, oh, wow, this is definitely like a branch off of what we know of Superman lore.
Mm-hmm.
The other character, Double A, was, you mentioned Granny Goodness already, whatever.
Granny Goodness.
She's a staple of Apokolips and that. She's been in the DC animated cartoons, and she was in, I think you get a little glimpse of in the Snyder.
See her there. Yeah, she is there.
Which was cool.
Very recognizable look.
Yeah. And now the other character in this Double A that I was familiar with was Light Rain.
He is a new god too.
Okay.
So he's part of that story. I'm not too familiar with him because I've really never really seen him.
Yeah.
In any of the cartoons or movies, I've never seen that one.
Yeah.
So
and we do get some appearances from some Superman staples like in here. I don't know if that's his real name in the comics, but like Carlo Mannheim. It's in the show. In the show, it's Bruno Mannheim.
Bruno, whatever. That's right.
But his name is different in here.
It probably is. But it's
might be the son or something. It's like
that. Yeah, you know what? I think he actually is.
And he's the leader of Intergang.
Intergang. Darkseid gave these guys like special weapons to cause chaos on Earth. But eventually, you know, they're always stopped by Superman and the other heroes.
Right. Obviously Lois Lane makes an appearance. Bibbo, classic Superman character. I mainly know him from the 90s. I don't know how long he's been around. but I was always see him in the 90s Superman comics, especially after the Death and Return. He was always there. So these are some of like all the characters, but the whole first issue pretty much is about, you know, the unveiling of this you know, Superman.
Darkseid really wants to go to war with New Genesis.
Yeah.
He's like, yes. Do everything you can to make Mr. Miracle go back to New Genesis so I can start my war. And so that's the whole thing. And then he finally got Superman's armor ready. So since there's not really like a yellow sun on Apokolips, he makes him a special outfit that's going to collect the energies to make him strong. One of his first deals is, you know, okay, you know, fight Kal-El.
Yes.
You know, which he
was another classic Superman villain, right?
Yes, and Darkseid's other son. And he fucking destroys Kal-El.
Big time.
Yeah.
Like, and he is like their champion gladiator. They're kind of doing Roman gladiator style. There's like a
arena. Kal-El is almost like almost like a thing character, thing? Like okay. In terms of strength.
Okay.
You know, like where he'll give some good blows to Superman, but Superman's eventually gonna overwhelm him.
Right, right. I think when Superman realizes, like, oh, you're at this level of strength, let me turn it up a little bit, and then he can, like, easily take a guy like that.
And what's brutal is that, like, Superman just, like, bashes his brains in. And like, he holds his head up, and, you know, he's like, you know, what do you want me to do with him, Darkseid? And he's like, kill him. And so he just starts bashing his fucking head. Like, they don't show it over and over, but they just show him where he's like, boom, yeah. You know? And then he's got blood all over his suit, so it's kind of like, shit, like, man, he just killed fucking Caliban.
And I gotta admit, though, like, I was a little bit like taken aback because I'm like, I'm not used to seeing, you know, Kal-El like it, this. You know, what
it's
I mean?
Crazy, it's right? Like, I was
like, damn. But then I gotta tell myself, like, raised on a whole other planet by pretty much the most nefarious guy in all of DC. Mm-hmm. So it's like, all
and
right,
too, you know, the costume again is so amazing, and I'm just seeing it now, and he has the red cape, and it just adds so much more to that suit. I mean, that suit is just really fucking cool. That it's a really cool design.
Yeah, and I told AA, I was like, man, that would be like a cool shirt to have with that.
It would emblem. Really cool. It
but I said it would be kind of iffy to wear because that the S on there almost looks like the German SS symbol. You know what I mean? So it's pretty.
So, let me see if you can.
Yeah, I mean, like it very much resembles the German SS symbol. Am I right, AA?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
I think that if you wore that around without people knowing, I mean, like
they might they without just kind of like glancing at it, they could, you know, be like, yeah. What the fuck?
On the opposite end, I've literally worn my, you know, my Star of David Colt shirt that I got from Colt Cabana. And I have been asked by people like, you know, are you Jewish? Or like, what does your shirt mean or whatever? And I'm like, oh shit, you know what I mean? Like, you know, I was like, I explained quickly, I'm like, oh, he's a wrestler, he's a Jewish wrestler or whatever.
You know, my wife has told me I've gotten dirty looks from like when I wear my Bullet Club shirt. Oh, they think I'm on a gun
club. A gun so. Club, yeah.
Yeah. So
no one thinks it's wrestling.
You know? All right.
Yeah, so I would hate to have to explain that I'm like, oh no, this is a Superman
shirt.
Yeah,
I have to explain it.
Like, what the hell, Superman is that? You know what I mean? So Lane is back. He says, this is an awesome comic series, but I think it's been out of print for a while.
It's been out of print.
Yeah. Oh, okay. And Lane, I was really shocked. Was when AA had me read it, and I liked it. I went to go, and I'm really glad you're back, by the way, because I know you said this is your favorite Elseworlds story. I was looking for a trade of all three issues in one, and I couldn't find one, even on eBay. And AA said you are able to find them, but they're over $50. So
on Amazon, I've never really looked at a comic book store because it's always kind of hard to find the side stories for whatever reason at the comic book stores.
Yeah.
Like they never have like an Elseworlds kind of like
section. Yeah.
You know, so that always kind of sucks.
It's funny because right now my nephew's collecting this What If series. It's called I think it's called Web of Shadows or whatever.
Okay.
And he's looking for one issue left out of like a 5-part series because it's under the What If label, but it was like like a 5-part story or whatever.
I think I remember that when it came out.
Yeah,
it was kind of weird.
And he was telling me that he was like, "Oh, it's apparently hard to find."
Yeah,
he's been looking for it too. Yeah. Whatever. So, Lane, can you tell us what resonated for you so much with this story? Why did you like it? What was the appeal of it to you? You know, I can remember this old story that was. It's called Superman the Nail, and it was about the nail that busted the tire of the Kents that put them into the path of them. And how about that, AA? There's a real quick brief opening. Sorry, guys, I got like an itch. There's a brief opening in the beginning when he first lands on Apokolips, right? And these two people find him, and their names are like Jonna and Marta.
Yeah,
and they're about to like capture or you know, they find, they're like, oh, a little boy, and we finally got our prayers answered, and they immediately get what zapped.
They get disintegrated
Is it by the Omega beam
by Darkseid.
And I've got to say this too, again, I haven't read a lot of like Darkseid stories, although I'm very familiar with the character Darkseid. Not very familiar, but familiar enough with who
familiar
he is
enough,
and his presence. And I mean, so for me it's like he roasts quite a few people in this series with the Omega beams. He's just okay, just, cool, there you go, you know what I mean. So I
need to answer your question there.
Oh yeah, there you go. Lane says
they put out a few years ago a Superman and Batman Elseworlds big trade. Wow,
some of the
stores, but they didn't include this one for some reason. Oh,
dang, that sucks. And then he says,
I liked it because the armor and seeing him,
Pwn, like with the Pwn is like a gaming term for Pwn, like Pwn Caliban.
Yeah, and we're just talking about that, like how he just like
an ass whipping,
head,
like
heading.
Yeah, so. And then too, it's kind of like, you know, a lot of people talk about, you know, we want a Superman story, like kind of like Justice League. What's the one? Injustice, where Superman goes nuts and is like, and this is a little bit different because he's not nuts.
He's not nuts.
He's just raised by Darkseid, and so he's a fucking vicious, it's
fucking scary killer. He's like the general that Darkseid probably always wishes he had.
Right, right, and again, it's interesting, right, the way, because he doesn't have his yellow sun powers.
No, but yeah, which I'm kind of like, I wonder how powerful they're going to do that. Yeah,
yeah,
but I think Darkseid already knows the Kryptonian biology. Mm-hmm. That's why he makes the suit. And I even kind of told you too. I was like, I wonder if that's where they got the idea for Superboy Prime, because Superboy Prime has to wear a suit
that
collects the rays, which makes him strong. So I was kind of like,
I wonder if they got that from here. And it's kind of neat because that last suit a little bit resembles Superman Prime's suit.
Yeah,
it's kind of
cool. Yeah.
Excuse me, Superboy Prime. Yeah. Real quick, Lane's comment says,
I like the moment when Darkseid says he is impressed the child didn't cower at him. Yeah.
Yes. That was really neat too, whatever, right? Because, you know, he finds him like as a baby. And again, Lane, I had said earlier, I don't know if you were here watching, but I had told Lane, I was like, man, I kind of thought that it was going to go through the paces of maybe like
Darkseid. I was kind of hoping.
I thought it was going to be like fucking Conan the Barbarian, right? Like fucking, you know, Kal-El's pushing these fucking things, getting whipped and shit. And like, you know, Granny Goodness is punishing it, which I think, I mean, I think there's room to still write that story.
I think
like,
there is a lot of room.
We don't see how he gets to this guy. You know, our first scene was this battle versus Kalibak, where he completely, as Lane said, pones him. And I mean,
look at that.
Oh yeah, that's his great. Please. Put that one up real quick, double A.
I don't know if you're gonna be able to see this for.
If you tilt it back, there you go. Just right here, this image right there. I'm sure double A will find these and post them on our Instagram throughout the week. Because I think there is some great imagery in here that's gonna be wonderful for us to talk about. Lane says here, double A says also, I would say I think it really featured
Light Ray and Orion a lot in it.
I agree.
Two characters who doesn't get featured very much. And well, hey, you know, Lex Luthor had a fun time with Granny Goodness.
You know, before we went in there, we talked about that. I love that wasn't a factor.
Get rid of it.
Make him a non-factor.
Yeah.
We had plenty of Lex and Superman stories. And seeing him be a total bitch was on a leash truly was really, really, really cool. Mm-hmm. I would like that side story as well.
Yeah.
Some more of that. He was basically a Channing Tatum in the fucking
This is the end.
He's like, oh hey guys, you know, what's up or whatever. Yeah. I was like, dude, Granny Goodness was Danny McBride. Ooh. Let's get Danny McBride to play Granny Goodness.
Ooh, right. That would be so fucking good. I do think the one issue with the story, it jumps to the redemption of Kal-El's story.
Yes. This is for me my part that I like.
And I knew he was gonna like
you
that,
knew I was gonna like that, yes. But let's talk about the rest of this first issue because so what's something cool too major
is,
happens.
Yeah, so what's cool too here is that so he catches Mr. Miracle trying to like do some shit and he paralyzes Mr. Miracle. He just kind of like punches him and he flies and he breaks his back.
Superman does that right to Mr. Miracle.
And so Mr. Miracle punches in the mother box and goes to New Genesis. And that's all Darkseid really needed for him. Superman comes in, he's like, you know, I'm sorry, Darkseid. He got away, and Darkseid's like, you did perfect. That's exactly what I wanted. Now we can go to war with New Genesis.
Yeah. And again, the strategist, the plotting, the machinations of Darkseid, you're like, oh shit, like this guy is like, he didn't care.
And he unleashes hell on New Genesis. He opens a portal, sends the parademons, they overwhelm the new gods who aren't ready. And then out just comes Superman just blasting with this bomb that they made that can blow up a whole world.
Yeah.
And, you know, Superman just goes through. It's like almost like if you guys like my brother loves saying this, it's kind of like if you guys ever seen Willow, it's like Kill through Eric's army, you know, where he just goes through a whole fucking army. Like there is no new god. There is no being other than the Sunlight Few that can get past Superman. I mean, there's just no one. When Superman's going to go through, he's going to go through.
And what's scary about that is that Darkseid knows this, right? Because there's even a part where Desaad says, well, Master, don't you think they'll stop the warhead before it comes into the missile warhead? And he says, well, if I was using a missile, but I'm not. I'm going to use my Superman, whatever. And it reminded me of the fucking Helm's Deep, the fucking orc that runs in with the bomb.
Yeah, no shit, right?
Like,
yeah.
So he fucking uses Superman like a warhead. He's got like, imagine Superman strapped with this nuke. And he fucking flies in like the center of the planet with the fucking nuke strapped on his back. I mean, I'm like, what a fucking destructive use.
So let me give you that line that Sam is just talking about. So Desaad, you know, actually Superman is the one that says, won't the new gods intercept the bomb before it reaches their planet? Mm-hmm. And he goes, Darkseid says, if it were mounted on a conventional missile, perhaps, but that is why you will deliver the warhead to New Genesis personally.
Damn. Man, I imagine that's what Sauron told that orc. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He's like, well, won't we not get through the wall at Helm's Deep? He's like,
And of course, Superman's like, hell yeah. You know?
Because
he strapped that shit on.
Yeah, because this guy is like, and it's so funny, right? There's so many images, right, double A throughout the panels that are like, you know, like live for Darkseid, die for Darkseid, right? Like,
yes.
This, and this is the whole thing, is he's like, no, I gotta serve this master, my creator that gave me, you know, he says gave him life, because he doesn't know. He doesn't know he's an alien from Krypton or whatever. He just knows that I've got to serve Darkseid. Mm-hmm. And he's all about that. And, again, one of Superman's greatest things is that he's so convicted, you know what I mean? So,
and here he is, he just burrows through the planet, puts a bomb right at the core and flies the fuck out, and the whole planet just blows up.
Yeah, it starts this thing, and you think like Orion and all them and Highfather are all just going to get roasted, but it's kind of like a wave, right?
So Highfather sends him to Earth, where it's going to be possible, and then he shows Superman what he could be. There's a prophecy about him of what he could be, and he ends up getting blasted to Earth too.
Lane bringing in some great comments here. Let's get to them. Double A says,
usually Carl Mannheim is the one ending up like Lex did in that story. Yeah, right. Yeah, he does.
And then he says here,
hey, a question to you guys. If someone did a statue of that Superman, that Darkseid armor, would y'all buy it? Yes.
Ooh, damn,
yes, I've looked for it already.
Right? Yeah, no statues?
No statues.
What's out there? Just a
figure. But man, if they did, which I don't know why they haven't, they can put so many different Batmans, so many different, you know, Wonder Womans. I was like, man, put this one on.
A big discussion on the Collecting Weekly guys shows have been recently double A's that these expensive toy making figures have been putting out multiple of the damn Heath Ledger Joker in the purple
that's
jacket.
What I'm saying,
and even they were like, can we get the nurse Joker? Can we get the bank robbery Joker? It's like, yeah, I mean, like, well, I mean, at least give us a different damn Joker. I'm like,
oh, then the usual one.
Then the usual, the purple jacket and the classic, you know, which again, if you were going to own one Joker, you would. First, you'd get that one, but I mean, if you're a collector of Joker, you want more than just that Joker. But I think this would be I think this would be a very badass looking figure if they made the armor kind of like a metallic looking, or even like a glossy black.
You can kind of see it right here. I mean, man, it's just a really cool visual.
I would want to remove a helmet too.
You got to put that red cape on. That red cape.
Oh, absolutely! It adds to the gravity and the Superman too. You know?
This just shows how powerful Superman is. That he smashes Orion and destroys the New Genesis and destroys it.
Yeah, absolutely. I felt like these guys were like, this is like Superman without a kind of a conscience.
Man, show what Superman can really do.
Uh-huh.
You know? A question, are you guys going to talk about that this was the basis for the Legacy 2-part for a Superman animated series? Since it came out similar time, even the costume was based off it.
Double A mentioned it a little bit or whatever, and I
don't think TM has really seen it.
I've seen the one where him and Darkseid have that big fight at the end.
And yeah,
that one, and I love that.
But the part one is kind of like almost all this, almost.
That's the one where he's telling him, right, where he's like, normally I have to hold back. He's like, but not with you, big man. Yeah. You can take it or whatever. And I was, I mean, I watched that shit just on its own on YouTube.
I remember when I first saw it, I was blown away by that episode. I mean, it was him and Darkseid just not holding back whatsoever. Mm-hmm. It was amazing.
I mean, even the, you know, we're gonna, I don't, spoilers, but we're gonna get to it, but the part where he's like, no one can stand up to the Omega Beam. Yeah. Like, and I'm then, like, fuck yeah. Then, you know?
We always talk about like really good voice acting. Michael Ironside as Darkseid fucking kills it as Darkseid.
It just makes you think, oh, you know, it's funny. Just made me think when you said really kills it, Michael Ironside as Darkseid. Agree, he does. But there he is. I always love how his like, however his head is, it looks like, almost like a beard, but it's like his fucking, the other thing my sister was watching was Masters of the Universe on VHS, no less.
Ooh,
and I walked in right at that end part with the battle, and I was just like, I just love seeing Franklin Joe like that. Yep. And Amy was like, man, this guy's really going for it. She says she thought it was, who did she say she thought it was? The actor that played, who did she say? Oh, she thought it was the actor that played Victor in Underworld.
Oh.
And she goes, yeah, I was looking it up. And I was like, no, Franklin Jill. And I said, and she goes, well, I just thought, because he seemed like a vampire, you know? And they kind of give him fangs and this goes. Mm-hmm. And I said, funny you say this, because this guy played Dracula. You know, Franklin Jill played Dracula.
And real quick, too. So I've read a lot of articles where the director of Masters of the Universe said he was very heavily influenced by Kirby's New Gods. And it's kind of evident when you see it, what Orion flies on, they fly on.
The discs? Wow.
When Skeletor comes from the portal, that's how Darkseid comes.
The boom tube.
Yes,
even my sister goes, that's some helmet, huh, bro? And I said, yeah
it's a Kirby kind of suit.
Wow. Yeah. Man, you see how things tie together?
Yeah, guys? So that's kind of like, I think, why they got away from the He-Man kind of stuff, because the guy was a big fan of that Kirby fourth wow. world stuff.
I told you I had a weird week. See, it was weird. All fit together. There you go. I was like, damn, I gotta tell my sister that. Okay, Lane, we want to get your comments. You got some great stuff here. Yes, Lane, we are going to talk about that. And I didn't know that those episodes were based on this. So that's very. I'll go watch those today for that.
Yeah, what? I mean, the
HBO Max. And
Lane says the closer you get to that Superman, the Darkseid armor is the Hellbat statue from Prime One.
Oh,
is kind of a Batman version of the Darkseid armor.
I think I've seen that. But you know what I thought of, Lane, and maybe you'll know, but there's one of those DC multiverse figures. You actually bought it for my nephew.
And I thought maybe that's what it was.
It's kind of based on it or whatever. But, man, it looks fucking badass.
Trust me, I wanted to keep
it. That figure is heavy. I pose it all the time. Yeah. And you know, it's funny. Initially, he didn't really get into it, but he loves that thing now. He will get it, pose it, move around. I love it too.
Cool. It's like
it's like a manga. It's almost like a manga Gundam, Superman, whatever. I don't know if that's from a comic or something. I'm sure it is because they base all that shit on the comics. Yeah. But McFarlane just absolutely kills it with those figures. And I got to tell you, you know, he really loved too the Boba Fett when he started posing it. He was like, this figure has a lot of cool articulation and poses.
Yeah.
Like, he was really into that Boba Fett.
All that too, stuff. Whatever. Yeah. Once you really get into it. Yeah.
And it's kind of sucks because when we look at the other ones, the Marvel ones, and we're like, man, we wish McFarlane did Marvel toys.
I don't know why McFarlane doesn't. He's so stuck.
I thought
on
you said he didn't like, he was still pissed off.
That's
at
the thing. It's like
let it go, brother. Make that money.
But you've seen his, you've seen him on Facebook, you've seen him on Instagram. He'll do Venom stuff. Yeah. He'll do Spider Man stuff. It's kind of like, man, why? I don't know. I don't
that
know.
That hurts deep, man. That's it.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what the deal is. Honestly, he's like all for DC, you know.
Every time I'm angry now lately at the house, my sister's like, bro, who hurt you? Whatever. And I'm like, who hurt Todd McFarlane? It's Marvel. It hurts me to say it. Lane also says
Legacy was the two-parter that ended the Superman animated series.
Oh, yes,
man. Yeah, the fight you're talking about is from the Destroyer end of the JL.
Thank you, Lane. I knew I was in the wrong series, is what I was thinking of. And then you say
Well, in Legacy, Lash got some Kal-El action.
Oh, okay,
But they learned in Batman Brave and the Bold, once you got Jonah Hex, you don't go back to the best
action. Come on now. but great stuff. But yeah, Double A. So let's talk. Is that how this first issue ends? He blows up the planet, essentially.
Yes, and Highfather kind of shows him what he could be, and so he kind of transports everybody to Earth.
Yes.
And Darkseid's like, what happened to Superman? And
right, because Highfather takes him to the Source Wall. And he shows him that message that
the Destroyer will be the creator.
Yeah, and he's like, what the fuck are you talking about?
Yeah, I'm
like,
this means,
which I was like that too. I was like, what are you showing me? And how can people just get to this Source Wall all the fucking time? I'm like,
that's like another Kirby creation.
Too, yeah, DC has some very interesting parameters to it that just kind of boggle me or whatever. But again, you know, I kind of grew up a Marvel guy, so it's hard for me to latch into all the DC things. I'm like, what? Like, I have to, like, sometimes I feel like if you don't know a little bit about DC, it could kind of be hard to jump in, because this was a little bit hard for me to jump
in. And that's the thing, though. What's funny, Sam, is that DC, when they really want to write a main story, they really use the Kirby stuff.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They really use the New God stuff. They really use Darkseid. I mean, almost that whole Snyder cut is Kirby, the Mother Bots, Darkseid, Steppenwolf, Granny Goodness, Desaad.
Boom Tubes.
I mean, it's all fucking that's the Kirby
very
shit.
True. Very you know? True. Which is, you know, rich, great storytelling. You know what I mean?
You know, they've just used it. They've used all the Kirby stuff. I mean, this whole thing was a Kirby love letter almost.
Yeah.
But with just Superman in it.
Lane says, sorry, I'll be good now. Actually,
No, brother.
We love it, man. Keep the comments going, man, because we love... especially when someone has a familiarity with the topic. I mean, that's
especially
really great.
There's not really a whole lot of people I know that really knew about this story.
So. Yeah, and I'm a Superman guy, and I don't know about it. Just we love it, man.
Lane, I love your input, too. So
Lane also says, it's because of your guys' little thumbnail for tonight. I just this afternoon contacted a comic shop in California to see if they have the back issues of this. So I can buy it. There you go, Lane. That's what we love, because this is what me and Double A have says all the time. We end up getting on someone's show. We end up talking about something. And then the next thing you know, I'm on fucking eBay buying Bravestar figures or whatever, you know, and a pair of Thundercats shoes later on. And then it's like, I go down the rabbit hole that we all do, because it's the stuff that reminds you, you know, that like made you happy, that you enjoyed reading. Dude, I hope that you land them or whatever. And tomorrow I may be at a show. And if I see a couple of copies, I'll keep you in mind, brother. Then Lane says here,
Hey, for you, yo guys, if you like the Elseworlds.
Yeah, absolutely. He says, Badfish is in the house. He says, hey, yo, thank God it's Friday, guys.
Yeah, big time.
Badfish was one of the guests I mentioned, AA, that was on After Dark this week.
Okay.
Badfish. Also, I want to say huge thank you, brother, for arranging the, you know what, I want to tell you something real quick, AA. It's a little bit of a side story, but Badfish is who reached out to me, that, and he said, if, what did I think about doing a little bit of a collection, a fundraiser for Zach, given his recent tragedy? Okay. And he was like, you know what, man, there's about 300 of us in this Patreon group, that's a paid group. Mm-hmm. He goes, if we just do 10 bucks, we'll raise about, you know, maybe either 300 bucks for Zach and his family. That's a great idea, man. Count me in or whatever. He said, you know, go more if you want, but everyone can just do, we'll ask for like at least 10. I said, great. Bad fish, let me gush for a second. And I said, sure, man. So I was like, that'll be really nice, whatever. Yeah, and I ended up having, you know, money's a little tight, but I was like, you know, I think I could probably do 30. So ended up dropping in 30 or whatever. The co-organizer with them is another great gentleman from the Collecting Weekly group, Marco. And we asked Marco for an update because it was going fast and furious once the people knew what was going on. And before you knew it, the Marco had and Badfish had asked, and in within maybe like, you know, half of a day, they were already up to $700 over the 300 that
Yarny, yes.
Before it was all done, AA, over $1,000 raised for Zach and his family, which was amazing. So, guys, bravo to you guys. Thank you so much for putting that together. Yeah. Cheers to you guys, definitely.
Oh, damn. Damn,
AA, it was incredible. We were able to get his daughter a $100 gift card to Build-A-Bear.
Okay.
We got him a gift card for him and his wife to hopefully go out and have a nice meal. $200 to HEB for some grocery needs. Because, you know, when you're dealing with something like this, AA, I think that's the last thing on your mind. Anything that makes it easier. Yeah. And obviously there's medical expenses, unfortunately, and all that. Yeah. So we really hope this all helped out. Again, me and AA would not be here with you guys streaming Just Another Friday Night on the Collective Weekly channel without Zach. So it's really amazing. So again, Badfish, dude, huge ups to you, man. That was fucking incredible, bro. So love that. And Lane says, hey, I'm Badfish. And then he says, hey, one thing, guys. Let's hear it. Let's hear it, Lane. And then Badfish says, at Linker Rain Man, how's it going? And he says, I'm happy to organize, man. Thanks for helping out. Absolutely. I was happy to do whatever I could. It wasn't much, but I'm glad that it was to be a part of that and that to have contributed. So then Lane says, he says, oh, they're just talking to, glad they're doing good. And Lane says, Zach is awesome. He said, he let me a few years ago come on CW stream, and it's been full speed ever since. That's great to hear, Lane. Yeah, we love you, man. I think I've seen you on there, and it's just been wonderful. The content. Then Badfish says, enjoying the night after a long week. Glad you guys, I hope you guys are having some drinks. Do that. That's normally I would be if I wasn't in this thing. He says, the community is awesome. Yeah, the CW community is really awesome. And then Lane throws up the super chat right there. $2. Hey. Appreciate you, Lane. He says, to Badfish and the CW team for being awesome. Yeah, thank you guys so much, man. That's really, really cool. And we're really enjoying having this conversation with you guys about Superman, the dark side, spelled regular dark side, right? AA, not dark side.
Like yeah, it's always, dark side for whatever reason. Kirby spelled it S-E-I-D.
Yeah, which I love, but it makes it hard when I'm writing Darkseid's name and like typing it. I'm like, fuck, how does it go again?
Yeah.
So, because it's supposed to be I before E, except after C, unless you're talking Darkseid, then it is E-I-D. So, that will help you not remember it. But yeah, back into the context, I just wanted to take a quick moment to gush and talk about that really awesome story that happened for Zach, because I think that's incredible.
It's incredible
to see what a community can do of collectors and of just friends, AA, and men and their spouses and or significant others that are just all pulled together.
Yeah,
I think that was great. Fucking badass, dude. Super badass.
That's great.
Lane says, okay, now back to the Superman and the dark side. Yes, totally. Okay, Dolly, so are we at issue 2 yet?
Yes, issue 2. So he's on Earth, and this is kind of like where he meets Lois.
Yes.
And this
is kind of... he gets teleported there from the source wall and kind of lands in the harbor, and Lois pulls him out. You know what I mean? And, you know, I thought it was going to be instant love connection. And I'm glad they didn't go with that.
I'm glad they didn't go with that.
Yeah, I thought it was going to be the whole love at first sight thing, but no, it wasn't.
So it's kind of like, you know, he starts being on Earth. He's kind of starts hanging on Earth. And the Superman in him starts coming out. You know, so
Lane says,
hey, is it possible to make a story request y'all might read at some point?
Absolutely, yeah. Man. Please throw that out there. Yeah. Well, we were just talking earlier, like, you know, because again, I love to do when we do comics or whatever, and we've got several things on the line. Yeah. But no, by all means, please. This is what we asked for way back early on, like when we first started. Yeah. We've been doing this for about, you know, three years now. And in our early, you know, endeavors, we were like, guys, you want something you want us to read? Give us requests. But we've covered Reborn, you know, Green Lantern. We mentioned three Jokers.
We did
Old Man Logan, yeah. Punisher Born, mm-hmm. Punisher the Platoon. Mm-hmm. We're huge Punisher fans. We want to talk Preacher at some point.
Which we kind of did a little bit.
We touched on it.
Craven's Last Hunt.
Yes, Craven's Last Hunt. And I just showed, we really want to talk about this story, which we've been, since this story was coming out, like when we first started the pod, and then it got like delayed, all the issues. And then we like got into other content. We never got back to Last Ronin. So we definitely want to do this one. But by all means, Lane, please, please, please drop that in the comments. I love the opportunity to read comics. So for sure. What were you going to say? I'm sorry, I kept interrupting.
No.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, okay. Lane says,
specifically, we had the chance, the Dark Phoenix saga from X-Men. Or if you get a chance for modern comic Deceased.
I keep hearing about that one. Yeah, where they're like the zombie. Mm-hmm. The zombies. I'm the absolutely Dark Phoenix for that.
Would be awesome. You know, and
we love the X-Men. Yeah.
And, you know, the Proteus saga. I love the Proteus saga, which kind of, you know, is before the Dark Phoenix saga. Mm-hmm. But, man,
just killer. Yeah, Mask of the Martyrs. I would say I'd have to get me a trade, though, because there you go. See, AA's got my back over here all the time. Now, the Deceased, I wouldn't mind picking it up so that way you could read it. Yeah. That way we'd have to just swap enough time to read it. AA reads way faster than I do.
Oh, so. And then Lane gives us another one.
For
the Punisher, you guys, can you do Welcome Back, Frank?
I will happily do Welcome Back,
Frank. We were going to start with the Garth Ennis Punisher.
Yeah. And I think that if you don't have those, I have those. That's something we both have. Yeah. Something we both have, you know, we both have Kingdom Come. We both have Watchmen. We both have Dark Knight Returns. There's a bunch of shit we both have, which I'm sure every comic book guy has. But right there, that's three requests. I will write those down. I will happily work on getting those done for you. What is Bad Fish
says, I really want to read The Last Ronin, but I couldn't find it anywhere when it first came out. I should grab the complete series. Is that the complete story?
Yes, it is. And Bad Fish, $20 on Amazon, brother. You're not in the U.S., right? So if you need me to help you out, brother, let me know. I get it for you, $20 U.S. I'm not sure if you are or not. I know Ben's in Canada, and so I'm getting everyone's geography down.
Yeah, so Superman starts going, this is kind of like, again, where you said the Fantastic Four Galactus. This is where Lois starts being like the Alicia Masters almost. And then he meets some people, and, you know, he starts doing good things. And he's like, man, you know what? This kind of feels real nice doing it. And then he starts finding out, too, that the Yellow Sun gives him, you know, his strength.
Yeah.
Which he's like, whoa, what the hell, you know?
And the whole time, it's something about the art that bothered me, right? So they give Superman this, like, kind of like cropped haircut that I didn't like. He looks
almost like helmet hair.
Yeah. they say he's a big guy, but they draw him to me kind of a little bit lanky. Yeah. He looks pale, right? And he's got these kind of arch eyebrows. He almost looked more like a Namor to me. And I was like, why does he look like that?
You know, for me, I thought Kid Miracle Man a little bit.
Oh, there you go. Yeah. And it was bothering me, right? I was like, this doesn't look like, you know, I want to see Clark Kent. You know what I mean? So it was bothering me.
Bad Fish says, yes, he's in Canada.
Okay.
And then Lane says, tomorrow I'm going to pick up Spider-Man 31 and drop Spider-Man. That comic is $9. And I already know it's going to make me mad. But Bad Fish says, I can buy it from Amazon.com.
Oh, perfect, man. Go check it out right now. $20
because the cover price on here is like $30.
Yeah, dude. That's what made me agree. And it's a hardcover.
It's hardcover. It's five issues. Man,
right? I mean, AA was like, that's a nice one. I was like, so you want to show it again?
I mean,
that's the back.
Hardcover.
Did you see the quote on the cover, Dilly? Robert Rodriguez.
Riveting from start to finish. Robert Rodriguez. Damn.
Who I had the pleasure of
reading. It has the introduction by director Robert Rodriguez. So, damn.
Oh, nice. I didn't even read that part. Yeah. Definitely. Let me know if you get that bad because you can shoot me a one-off about that. So.
Yeah. And it's a really good series. I was like really blown away. That's a really good series.
And I got it written right here. Lane Phoenix. Dark Phoenix Saga, right? We said Dark Phoenix?
Yeah. Dark Phoenix. Saga. Yes. Yes.
Dark Phoenix Saga, Deceased, and then Welcome Back, Frank.
And then Lane says, I am not a shipper per se, but there are three comic relationships I'm invested in. Rogue and Gambit, mm-hmm. Batman and Catwoman, and Black Cat and Spider-Man. And well, they break up in a stupid scene. That sucks. So there, he's back with Black Cat. Okay.
I'm like, okay.
And then Lane says, read The Last Ronin. It's very good. To Batfish. He says, read it. And it is the opposite of anything in the Turtles with
Jenkins.
Janica.
But take us back, Double A, in there. What happens next, after Lois finds him?
Yeah, he encounters like Mannheim's gang, and again, he's just like, damn, you know, I'm doing a lot of good deeds, and it feels great.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Darkseid's with Metron. Metron's starting, you know, tries to be like, because Metron's supposed to be like neutral, like he can go visit Darkseid and Highfather.
Is he like the Watcher?
Maybe, okay. Yeah, because like the Mobius chair gives him all this knowledge, so that's all he really cares about. Mm-hmm. Well, Darkseid is like, you're not going anywhere, and he fucking just blasts him away,
which I thought was badass because I remember his character too. I think even played a part in some of the DC shows. You know, the Greg Berlanti verse.
So here it's Darkseid's pissed because he goes, "You need a Kryptonian to have solved the secret of the anti-life equation," which he's always all about.
Darkseid's obsessed about the anti-life
equation. The secret which has eluded me for millennium. Mm-hmm. Yet you dare try to keep it from me, to which Metron is like, it is too great for a power for one man to well.
Right.
And then that's when he's like, are you attempting to leave right now? And he's like, you forget that since I provided you with the X element that powers your Mobius chair, I know how to neutralize it. And your travels have reached your end, scientist. And Metron just gave that look like, oh fuck! And then he just blasts his ass. He disintegrates his
ass.
And the
classic like Z zipping Omega beams. And again, I love this too because this is, you know, Darkseid being this strategist, being this, you know, unstoppable force. You know what I mean? And when he fucking just roasts Metron, I was like, he really getting the Omega beam action going, which I always am like, why isn't he just fucking zapping everybody? Like sometimes I'm like, you know, everyone loves to talk about the time that Batman beat up Darkseid, and I'm like,
he would have just blasted him, just
roast that motherfucker
like he does, like with three people in this fucking
exactly. He's letting loose that shit. And a great win, Batfish said it was on the Canada Amazon too. So
nice.
Win, very brother, nice. Win on that one. I was like, for 20 bucks, great price. I will not pass 20 that bucks. Up. That's a great price. Totally. Lane says,
Mary Jane had become Jackpot 3. Okay, I think by the end of the year, Mary Jane and Black Cat will be making out. Oh shit, with each other.
They're taking them the Harley Poison Ivy route.
Hey, you know what? Just make Peter the meat in that challenge, please.
Oh, please. Dang. I'm sure he'd like that too. So what's next, though?
We got introduced to Lex, who, you know, of course has captured a demon. And you know, he's like, you know, we can put an end to this, blah, blah,
Lex
blah.
Lex is going
to
Lex, huh? I'm like, all right.
Superman saved some more people, and he's like, man, this feels really nice to be doing this. And people are like, man, he's our Superman. This guy is badass.
And what I like is that throughout, he has, again, guys, this resonated with me, and I think Double A, obviously, he's using, you know, Surfer stuff as a reference, even calling Lois and Alicia Masters, which I love. And again, I'm a huge Surfer fan, so I love that. And it is, because he's even saying, he's like, well, why are these humans we're saving? You know, why do you think whatever? Like, he becomes loyal to Lois because she helped him. He becomes, you know, friendly with Bibbo and with Jimmy, you know what I mean? And he's curious about the action. I love how, you know, Bibbo relates it to like, oh, he's a veteran with PTSD.
Yes.
He's talking about war. Mm-hmm. And I was like, damn, this is like, that's just deep. You know what I mean? I was like, man, that's pretty deep. And he's like, hey, big guy, like, I know what it's like or whatever. And he's like, what do you know of war? He's like, oh, I was here, and here. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I don't know if that's ever been a part of Bibbo's story before. I'm not that
I don't know.
Yeah. But I dug I that big time. I dug that big time. And then he becomes a little bit endeared to them. And when he sees Bibbo doing these heroics, he's like, oh, there's a fire, buddy. We got to try to help people. He's like, why? And he's like, because it's the right thing to do. This is our neighborhood or whatever, you know? He's like, all right. You know what I mean?
It's like, they're protecting their own.
Yeah.
It's not anything that Darkseid or Apokolips has ever taught him. So he's kind of like, what the fuck?
Right. And again, this is like the natural nature of who Kal-El is. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? This is, you know, now we're seeing, you know, a bit of the Clark Kent come out where it's like, you know, when faced with righteousness and good, he naturally gravitates towards it, which is what I love about Superman. That's why he's like my all-time favorite character. Go ahead, Double A.
Yeah, and then so he starts getting attacked by some of the gods. Barda comes and the Furies. She's part of the Furies. That's Granny Goodness.
Yes.
And obviously she's like very attractive because, I mean, he's like top shit. So,
yeah. And has she always been a babe in the comics too? They've always made her a babe. Okay, yeah. Because I can't remember her too much, but seeing her, I'm always like.
And then they start fighting off the new gods, and Orion comes, and Orion's all fucking full of piss and vinegar, and he starts getting so angry that he starts looking like Darkseid.
Yeah, which was crazy. I was like, oh shit, is that how he looks when he freaks out?
Yeah, and he's like, and this is a great line that they kind of go. He's like, he tells him, I know that voice. I know you're the one who destroyed my planet.
Yeah,
you know, he's like, I will never forget that voice.
Which I wanted to ask you, Double A. I know you're not big on redemption like I am. Well, you know, did you feel? I mean, like, come on.
Look, this guy, like in this one, he's just totally brainwashed. He landed on a planet. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's being led by Darkseid. Darkseid knows the importance of what he would be.
Yeah,
Metron told him who he was going to be.
Yeah,
and so Darkseid's like, he's just a weapon. So this guy wasn't even taught. It's just how to be this fucking indestructible warrior.
The blood instrument. Yeah, you know what I mean.
Yeah,
And is this the issue, Double A, where they talk about that the Kryptonians hid the anti-life equation? Yes.
That's the one where he tells Metron, he's like, you tried hiding that information from me.
I thought that was a cool twist too. Like, that's pretty.
It kind of is.
They've never said that, but I was like, how neat.
But you know what? That kind of reminded me of Man of Steel. Mm-hmm. When Zod is looking for the fucking, what is it, the DNA of the Kryptonians? Oh, right. And he's like, it's in Kal-El's body.
Yeah.
That fucking Jor-El put in. I was like,
That's pretty cool. Right? Wow, they make that connection. Yeah, that's really great. Damn, I love that. It adds to the gravity of Superman and who he is, whatever. You know?
Yeah.
I always tell Double A, I say, you know, one of his greatest powers is you know, he doesn't give up. You know what I mean? Like, Superman will keep fighting until his last breath. And he will especially.
Oh, he's going to fight.
Yeah. He's going to go to bat for those he loves. You know, when it's Lois and Jimmy and Perry, you know what I mean? It's like, he's going to give you everything he's got. You know what I mean? You know, obviously we saw that, and we talked about this in Death of Superman. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It's like when he's fighting Darkseid, Doomsday, he's going to go until he cannot go anymore. You know what I mean? And he can go a lot. You know what I mean? Yeah. His durability is one of his greatest powers. You know what I mean?
And this is the line that, real quick, though, Orion says when he first sees him. He goes, even without your armor, warrior, I recognize the voice of the monster who destroyed our homeworld. Mm-hmm. Now your time of reckoning is at hand.
Yes.
It's like
very deep. Very, very poetic, right? So Greek mythology. Lane says, how did you guys like how Lois was handled in this series?
I liked her. I liked the Lois a lot. I thought it was very good. Mm-hmm. She's feisty.
Yeah, classic Lois, classic reporter, you know, getting into stuff. Also, at the same time, kind of educating, kind of dealing with this, in a sense, a man-child.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I thought she was very good, and it wasn't a lot of heavy-handed Lois.
No.
Sometimes Lois can be a little heavy-handed. It was so interesting because, you know, a week ago on the Now Watch This podcast, Joe was saying how he's never been a Lois Lane fan, which is funny because, interesting, because Lane, you were saying you ship Peter and Spider-Man and Black Cat, which is like not a Mary Jane fan, I take it. but yeah, it's interesting because I so much love the Miles and Gwen thing that's going on for me. But I've always liked Lois. I thought she, you know, I think of Terry Hatcher, you know what I mean? I think of Bitsy Tulloch, you know what I mean? And the Superman Lois show, she's great. Excuse me. I'm sorry, guys. Throat getting dry from talking. But so I thought they did a great job. Ling, what did you think about the way that they handled Lois Lane? I'd love to hear your opinions on that. You say here, maybe this is what you're saying.
This is a different take on the Kryptonians, where they would find the anti-life equation.
Yes.
It removes a lot of the humanity that we have seen and how they have been presented in more recent decades. Yeah, big time. Mm-hmm. And it looks like Jess in the house. What's up, Jess?
Hey, honey, how you doing? This is my lady.
Nice to see you here.
Yeah, I think you may be the first lady speaking tonight. Always cool to mix it up.
It's funny how she gets drawn to Orion in the series, not Kal-El.
I know. And that was kind of, and again, too, I like that they didn't focus a lot on that, but that was neat. Like, that was a twist for me at the end. I was like, what the fuck? I was like,
big time.
I mean, I've seen them put Lois with Lex, which I always hated, you know what I mean? But I was like, wow, Lois with Orion, very interesting. In some other world it exists. The Everyday Collector's in the house. He says, hey guys, what's up, Everyday Collector? We appreciate you being here, bud.
Well, it's been 23 years since I read the story, so for blow for blow, you're pushing me here.
And Jeremy says, hi, Mom. And then Lane says, hiya, John. That's to the Everyday Collector. John, appreciate you being here. And then Jess says hi to her son.
Yeah, so the mother box starts like talking to, you know, Superman, and then Orion can't believe me. He's like, what the fuck's the mother box doing? Like,
yeah,
telling you you're the protector and all this shit. Why is it protecting you? And he just like, and he's like, what the fuck's going on?
You know? Right. And again, too, it's kind of hard to, you know, you've got to remember Orion's perspective is like, you blew up my fucking world or whatever. You know what I mean?
It's yeah,
like,
and it's right here. He goes, how can the source protect the destroyer of our world? Surely this must be one of Darkseid's deceptions. Like, what the fuck? What's going on here?
Double A, real quick, because we have very strong opposing opinions on things like this. Like, do you feel as though this Kal-El deserves redemption?
Yeah.
Even though he blew up.
Yeah, because Highfather already knew. He's like, it wasn't your fault. And he's like, this wasn't your destiny. This was not supposed to be what happened. Your destiny got fucked with by Darkseid and Metron.
And it even made me think, in this Elseworld, that had to happen for Kal-El to figure out who he was and who will eventually, while he may have caused millions of deaths on that planet, it probably inadvertently set him on the path to save billions of lives. Yeah. So a classic, needs of the many outweighs the needs of the few, but it doesn't change like Surfer, right? Surfer obviously destroyed many worlds.
And again, he's still considered a very cosmic threat because of what he was able to do.
Yeah.
And Light Rays, you know, here he's trying to tell Orion, calm down, Orion, you know, Darkseid's not influencing any of this. This is a message from Highfather and the Mother Box. They know what's really going on. Calm down. And, you know, he goes, I don't know why. Superman goes, I don't know why it's picked me, Light Ray. I was raised by Darkseid to be his ultimate warrior. I was taught to take his word as absolute truth.
But since Darkseid's word is law. Mm-hmm. I know he says that a couple of times. I was like, whew.
But since I have come to this world, I find myself troubled by my actions. And, you know, it's just like everyone's fucking confused. They stop fighting. Everyone's just kind of like, what the hell's going on around here? Like, do we fight this guy?
Yeah.
You know, do we kill him? You know, he's being protected by the mother box. It's like, what's going on? And then Barda can't understand it. He's like, you know, he tells Barda, I really don't want to, you know, work for Darkseid anymore. And she's like, you know, are you fucking kidding me? You're a war of Apokolips. You're born to do battle for Darkseid. So it's like, shit, it's somewhat shit going on here, you know?
Yeah, no doubt. So, Double A, should we forgive Grand Moff Tarkin for blowing up Alderaan? Oh,
no, that guy knew what he was doing.
Piece of shit.
Everyday Collector says,
hey, Elaine.
Lane. And then Lane says, I think she is handled well. Mm-hmm. I do wish we got a little more of Barda and the Furies in it. Yeah.
Yeah.
The problem is there are so many Fourth World characters. Yes. Yes.
And again, Elaine, for me, this is kind of like a little bit of my first exposure to the Fourth World, really. Yeah. But I know that Double A has always been a huge fan of the new god.
So in Marvel, Jack Kirby wanted to get rid of the Norse gods, and he wanted to bring the new gods.
So he's going to kill off Thor?
Yes. But Stan Lee had said no, because Thor was a big seller.
Yeah.
But it was like, damn, if this had been handled by Marvel, I bet you this would have been a huge hit for him if they had killed him, because that's where they got the new gods.
Right.
When the old gods die, the new gods are alive.
So what happened, Double A in DC? Did it just not take off for them?
It didn't, because they wanted him to...
He was writing and drawing.
He was writing and drawing, which he was not a fan of writing. He wanted to do the writing. He wanted to give it off to someone else.
Yeah.
DC told him no.
Yeah.
And it was like, well, shit, you know, okay. You know, and so he's writing like about 5 books at this time.
Yeah.
He's writing and drawing 5 books for DC at this time. Yeah, and they all get canceled after a while. Ugh. But the idea was there, to where DC has been pretty much writing off these books for the whole time.
Yeah.
They're still using his stuff.
Yeah.
From like 1970s, they're still using it, and they're still, you know, making stories out of it.
Makes sense. I mean, I would say that Darkseid's still your best villain.
Yeah, by far. So, yeah. Jeremy is here. He says, by the way, sorry for being quiet, guys, but I have zero knowledge of any of this.
All good, bud.
But I'm glad you are going into depth. I mean, it's just a really cool story, Jeremy. It's just, again, if he was raised by Darkseid.
Yeah, and Jeremy, you know? I think that if they, I do not know why that the DC animation house has not tapped this story. After me reading it, I was like, this would be fantastic. It would be you know, in this, again, in the same way that when me and Double A talked about Death of Superman, we said, man, you know, what kind of sucked about it is it was like this, like, sorry version of the Justice League. So when they do the cartoon version, it's like they cleaned it up and it's the Justice League there, which is much more, you know, refreshing. So, I mean, again, I wouldn't want them to get rid of the New Gods, but I mean, I think that's what they would do to make it more, you know, palatable for the general audience. But it's still a cool story. I mean, it would be cool to see him in the armor. It would be cool to see people. What do you think of this? I mean, obviously Injustice had its fans because, I mean, everybody thought, like, oh, this evil Superman is badass. I think, go ahead.
Do you like how the anti-life equation is handled in this series?
I did, because that comes up so often. And again, I mean, like, I don't know in the regular comics if Darkseid ever finds that or whatever. Yeah, it's kind of like this MacGuffin. Like, it's out there, but it's never
You know what? Recently, he actually went to try to suck the power of the Lantern battery.
Mm.
And Hal actually held his own against the Omega Beam.
Oh, nice.
He put up a shield that withheld it for like a few seconds.
Okay.
But it was enough to buy him time to get the fuck out of the way from his high beam.
I was going to say, he didn't get killed. So
you know, obviously, Darkseid has so much fucking willpower that the Green Lantern power is going to be real easy for him to get his hands on, you know?
Yeah. I mean, that's a guy that's pure will, I would imagine. Yeah. I think Jess is referring to Grand Moff Tarkin being a piece of shit, which he is. Yeah.
And then this sounds like a great story. Bad Fist comes in. It really is. It's just three issues. It's three issues of Superman.
But unfortunately, you know, Bad Fist, like Lane was saying, it's out of print, so hard to find. Which I experienced too after I read it. I was like, I want to get me I sometimes have like a nice trade. I love to have a nice hardcover. I love to have a nice hardcover, but I don't even think I'm going to find that. So I would have settled for
I had to buy them for like,
I'm gonna look tomorrow at
$24. I just coughed up the money for these three issues.
Yeah, and they're nice too. They're the glossy covers and the nice glossy pages inside too.
And so, just the same, I don't know either, but lots of good info as usual, guys. Good
trip. Thank you so much. I appreciate that. Yeah, again, just a really fun, interesting story. You guys know that we like to read stuff that's different and like engaging, and we're like, people don't know about this. You know, what's funny, what got me to read the Batman Whatever Happened to the Caped Crusader Jess was like, did you know about this? And she was watching the same TikTok that I'd watched, which talked about the Alfred story with the actor friends. And I said, yeah, it's so funny, I just saw that myself and I wasn't familiar with the story. So I picked it up, which again, I don't think was as good as this. This was better to me. And not because it's Superman and that's Batman.
But sometimes it's
beautiful. I mean, beautifully drawn.
There's times it's kind of like you think maybe someone like Neil Gaiman would kind of do it, but it's kind of hard. Neil Gaiman has a style that fits Neil Gaiman.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it goes into like the modern superheroes. I don't know if it crosses over very well.
Right, right.
You know what I mean?
That whole story feels like you're in the dreaming, like it's like a dream sequence. Like, I'm like, what's happening? Like, I was confused because it jumped around or whatever. And then by the end, I was like, oh, okay, like I get it now. I was like, that's kind of cool.
Like, I hear his Marvel 1602 series is pretty damn good.
Okay, I haven't read
it's that like one the yet Victorian either. Ages, the but Victorian he ages, takes yeah. like the characters in that.
I wonder
if people love that series.
They do that first before they did the Gotham by Gaslight, which was like the Batman chasing Jack the Ripper. Yeah, which kind of like, I was like, oh, that's an interesting
answer.
We're a little bit behind on some stories. We got a lot to read. I have a stack. I'm sure we all have a stack we're sitting on. I keep thinking about that meme where it's like the young self visits the older self, right? And he's like, when I'm a grown up, will I be able to buy all the video games I want? And he's like, yes. And then he hugs him in the next panel because he's like, but you won't have any time to play them. And you're like, fuck, like story of our lives, right? Guys are like, I can buy the comics now, I just don't have any time to read them. So I'm literally Burgess Meredith in the Twilight Zone.
Whenever I buy a comic, I try my damnedest to read it
right then
and there.
When I bought the Whatever Happened to the Caped Crusader, I was reading it, right? And my nephew comes in and he's like, what you reading, Unky? And I was like, oh, I'm reading this Batman. Then he's like, oh, okay. And then I closed it, right? Because we started talking. And I put it in the bookshelf. He's like, don't put it in the shelf, you'll never finish it. And it took me like 3-4 weeks to get back to it. Because I was like, he's right. Once it goes on the shelf, it's like, I'm not going to get back to it right away.
They show Darkseid with Desaad in his torture lab, which is, you know, just torturing the fuck out of people and taking out their limbs.
Yeah, and like heads. There's heads in jars and shit. I was like, what the thick fuck.
Yeah, and then, you know, one of the Furies tells Darkseid, you know, Superman's alive. Which, you know, makes Darkseid like happy. He's fuck yeah.
Yeah.
You know, Lois goes to Lex, they're like, yeah, we're getting the armor. We're picking up his pieces, and we might be able to get going with something like this, because we find out that Mr. Miracle made it, and he's helping Lex with the technology and shit like that.
Yeah, so, classic Lex trying to recreate the tech of something else that can, you know, enable.
Yeah, you know, and then, you know, Superman's trying to find the armor. He's like, "Fuck, it was here, but mm-hmm. it's not here anymore." Mm-hmm. Then, you know, Darkseid sends some people to get Superman back. They're like, you know, he goes to Granny Goodness, or Darkseid finds Lex. Yeah, and Lexus transports his ass to Granny Goodness, who, and Granny Goodness has this fucking really nasty torture device that it looks like she's going to be using on Lex big mm-hmm. time. So, mm-hmm. yeah, so I was like, oof.
So he handled the Lex scenario really quickly, which I thought was cool. I was like, okay, we're taking that out of here. Because there's so many stories, right, AA, where it's like Lex ends up playing this big part, like in the background, mm-hmm. whatever. You know, we saw that, I think, in not Red Sun, but what was the other one we watched? It was one of the other ones we watched. And I was kind of just like, really, this dude, whatever. Like, you know, I want to give Lex all his kudos, you know what I mean? But I'm like, and sometimes with a story like this, it's like, you know, let's take that element out so that way we can focus on the kind of the two, you know, main protagonists and antagonists here.
Yeah, and then Darkseid goes to Mr. Miracle, and he's like, you know, I, you know, for all the bad, you can have the Mobius chair. He's like, all I ask is just for your allegiance and Kal-El. Mm-hmm. So pretty much like stop helping these fucking humans, and yes, just, you can have the Mobius chair, just, you know,
yeah,
fuck off, pretty
yeah.
much.
Yeah, get out of
you
my
know?
Way.
And then, you know, Superman goes back to Apokolips, and they're trying to kind of like reprogram him, you know, they're kind of like, he's a little fucked up.
Yeah, he's getting tortured for a while.
Tortured, but I mean, you know, they're like, you know, you're our main guy. You're my main fucking dude, you know. Right. I need you in top shape.
Right.
You know?
Totally.
Yeah. And Darkseid's actually kind of like, man, you know, like I really want my guy back. I really want my general back, you know?
That's interesting too, right? Yeah. You know what I mean? So it's he's not one to really care about.
Yeah. You know what I mean? So, like the last part right here, he goes, you know, I defy you and my father, Darkseid. I will do everything in my power to stop you from destroying Earth the way you did New Genesis. And, you know, to which Darkseid's like, you know, have I taught you nothing? You know, good and evil are irrelevant. The only meaningful division is between the conquered and the conqueror.
Yeah, that
to
was
concern yourself with the grim. Fate of lesser beings is to become one. So he's like, you know, like snap out of it, motherfucker. You know,
true,
like,
true. Only the strong survive, right?
Yeah, AA, yeah, right? But he wants, you know, Superman back. He's like, you know, don't be fucking weak here. You know,
he wants him to see his enemies driven before him yeah. and hear the lamentations of the women. Lane says,
oh, if you guys want to kill your brain cells and want to stick pencils in your ears from the sharp side, go read Batman Catwoman. That like implies Selina slept with the Joker. Oh.
This is like when we said that Snyder was supposedly going to have Lois be pregnant with Bruce Wayne's baby. I was like,
yeah,
that would have been like, I would have been like, fuck you, Zack Snyder. After that, I'm like, I gave you a lot of room. I was like, but that would have hugely turned me off. And while I don't mind Selina sleeping with the Joker as much as, like,
that is weird,
not
though.
That, you know what that I mean? Like, weird. That like, is, that is.
I'm how really does Joker like, fuck? Like, you would think he'd be, like, sadistic as hell.
Yeah, I mean, obviously Harley, she's a babe, you know what yeah. I mean? And Punchline's a babe now, too. So
that's what I'm saying.
He's like, got some, Joker's got something going on there with that pasty white thing. Lane also says, okay, if you guys do any reviews of the animated movies based on Batman stories, Doom That Came to Gotham, Long Halloween are both great. I'm going to write those down too. And yeah, because I'm always looking for those.
The Long Halloween, that's, you know, one of Jeff Loeb's classic Batman stories. So
go ahead, AA.
Yeah, so we get started again.
Issue 3, the final part of
issue
this story.
And, you know, they're back on Apokolips. And, you know, Darkseid is, well, actually, Darkseid gets rid of Mannheim again. So another kill on Darkseid in this.
Yeah. Who does he get that time? Oh, yeah. Mannheim. Yeah.
You know, the mother box kind of comes alive because Darkseid's like, you know, Superman's like really weak again. You know, there's no yellow sun anymore. Mm-hmm. And Darkseid's about to start torturing him when the mother box comes to him. And yeah, he fucking, I want to say maybe he, that punch, you know, he punches Darkseid. I don't know if he fucking kills him or not. But,
yeah. But, I want to tell you real quick, the way I forgot, but I know that we were saying before, again, guys, I've been gushing about the Superman and Lois show on the CW. It is like one of their best things I've ever seen them do. I would say maybe the best since Smallville. I would go that far to say. And again, I didn't watch a whole lot of those other ones, but I know that people love The Flash, but it's really, really excellent, especially if you're a Superman fan. But in that show, the character's name is Bruno Mannheim. And I didn't realize this, but there's been some Walking Dead alumni there, because obviously Lex is being played right now by
Abraham. Michael Cutlets.
Michael Cutlets. Bruno Mannheim is played by the gentleman that was Tyrese.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, really? Yeah. I didn't realize that at first, because he's a little heavier set in this one. And I was like, oh, damn, that's him. Somebody was saying, like, since The Walking Dead. So that's very cool. Let me get to Lane's next comment, W, while you're catching up there. Lane says, oh, another recent story. It's not great, but MC Mech might be worth checking out. I mean, it has Apokolips enter conquer mode, aka transform into the planet-sized mecha Darkseid unicorns.
Whoa.
Wow.
Holy shit.
Lane, did you read the DC Metal? That was one that I saw got a lot of love. And I was like, are they musicians? Like, what the hell is going on? Is this like Rock?
Yeah, it was weird. Yeah, it was kind of like that. Yeah, it was kind of weird. Yeah.
Yeah, some of those big DC stories me and AA don't really get to unless we hear something about it later on.
The one I want to read the most, if it's Batman, I want to read that Court of Owls. They actually
I hear good things about that one. Yeah,
Court of Owls, and they actually really tried recruiting Nightwing.
Oh, really?
Into their ranks, which I'm like, damn.
That's my guy right there, yeah. Nightwing, man. Again, the true leader of the Bat family, in my opinion.
I love the dialogue in Superman and Darkseid.
Yes, yeah, I love it when they're really talking. It's very, like I said, very like, you know, Greek tragedy. You know what I mean? Like, it's so grandiose. I really love it. yeah, and I'm a bad Batman fan, too, because I haven't read The Long Halloween and Hush, which I know is like crime. But I want to read them because I think that, again, we always say that Batman has the most interesting stories because it's easier to tell than it is when it's like they're superpowered. But this is done very well in that sense because they put an equally powerful opponent for Superman. You when you give him a good villain, you can get a great story.
You know what I was saying the other day is like the Hulk has been running for decades and has many, many classic stories. And I'm like, you know, the bullshit excuse for Superman is that, well, he's just too powerful. We can't write him. How is it that there's been so many successful writers that could write Hulk stories, but, you know, after a while, people give up on Superman? You know what I mean? Like, they're the same. They're both outrageously powerful comic characters. But how come the Hulk has been able to have more success when it comes to the storylines?
I think that's a great point. I mean, that's a great point. And, you know, it makes me hungry for a Peter David Superman story if there's not one.
Yeah, because Peter David was able to do it for like 12 years.
Yeah, for a long time.
Everyone gives up on Superman like after like a year or two. It's kind of like...
And prayers to him, too, because I heard
he's doing pretty bad.
Some health concerns. Yeah. Guys, and I think there's a GoFundMe for Peter David if you're a fan of the Hulk or just comic books and comic book writing. Go give
that's
a little
the Hulk guy. Donation yeah, that's the, to you know, Peter yeah. David,
the Hulk guy. Yeah. But no, that's an excellent point.
It's kind of stupid.
And you know? Someone might say, an argument might be that it's like, oh, you know, Hulk's anger makes him like an almost like an anti-hero. You don't have that with Superman. You know, so you have him kind of like, you know, written like that. Like, I don't think a Superman series would work. Well, no, it kind of did. I was going to say a Superman series wouldn't work like the 70s Bill Bigsby Hulk, but it kind of did because the serialized... You know,
but they found ways, Sam, where
George Reeves one was kind of like that,
like stories like where he's fighting the army,
right?
You know, stories that you're finding like all these other creatures, it's like, man, it works, you know what I mean? Like, you know, that's why I kind of people like want to rush to Batman right away because it's easier. That's what I feel. Because it's easier to write.
There you go. And I thought this was a very rich, well done story by a writer who I'm not really familiar with.
Yeah.
And it was told because, again, you gave him a proper antagonist. And you always want to stick with, like,
just do 6-issue miniseries, and I'm good with it.
Right. Yeah. That's fine.
Lane says, just so you know, a long Halloween movie is 3 hours long.
I'm good with that.
It's in two parts. Hey, for a comparison show, read Gotham by Gaslight comic. Then watch movie. Big difference. Both are great. I didn't know they made an animated movie.
Yeah, I saw it on there. Yeah. And you know what we have done, Lane, if you go back, is we did this with, watched Superman Red Sun, and then we did Superman Red Sun, the animated one, but then I went and read the comic, and I loved the contrast.
And then we kind of did that with the Flash, Paradox.
Yes, the Flash Paradox. Flashpoint. Yeah. We're talking about Gotham by Gaslight.
And then Lane says, I have DC Metal and DC Death Metal.
Okay.
Both pretty decent. I would read Metal, DC Death Metal. I didn't like as much.
Okay, interesting. Interesting.
And a lot of people don't like Death Metal.
Well, I was curious. Double A, you're a Death Metal fan.
I like Death, the band Death.
Ah, the band Death. Okay.
Which is the whole reason for Death Metal.
But one of our first, I think, Instagram friend slash followers was a
intoxicated.
Weren't they a death metal band? Uh-huh. Yeah, so that's pretty badass. Yeah. I mean, you know, and they're that shit's heavy.
DC death metal is almost too weird since it's got the Batman who laughs. But he's got the worst form in that when he becomes the Darkest Knight. Basically, evil Joker Batman with powers of Dr. Manhattan. Holy shit.
Wow, that sounds fucking bananas. Who's a writer on that?
That should be Snyder and Capullo still.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Well, I got to tell you, you know, again, that's another character that people fell in love with, right? Yeah. The Batman who laughs.
Yes.
He's in Fortnite. You know, my nephew has a figure of him. He doesn't really know who he is, but he's just like, this figure looks so cool. He's got the big wings. And I mean, and he looks fucking freaky, whatever. I'm like, that guy looks like a death metal guy, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
But back to the Superman, the dark side.
Jeremy says we love death metal over here. All right, Jeremy. Shit. Yeah, I do have death their albums, and yeah, that's
death the band.
That's good shit right there. Mr. Miracle. Now you know with the Mobius chair, right? You know, he tells Orion the real origin of who they are, both of them. Which Orion kind of throws into a big fit, of course. Then we go back to Apokolips, and man, we get this great fucking image of Granny Goodness, just like CM was saying about this is the end, with Luther like on all fours right there, like it's scared so shitless. Like, man, where he's just being tortured and
and this is clearly way before from 98, right? But it just right away in my mind, I saw Danny McBride and Channing Tatum, and he's like, oh, hey guys, you know what I mean? When he's all fucking holy shit, that's
hardcore, man.
Yeah, when the other guy's like, that's Channing Tatum. I would cast Channing Tatum as Lex Luthor just to recreate that scene and Danny McBride as Granny Goodness.
No shit, like, because like every time they did Granny Goodness in the Superman show, like she had a man voice,
yeah,
you know, and I forgot what actor it is. It's like a name actor, but it was like, what the fuck? Like, that's weird,
dude. And then Danny Bright is like, he's like, you see that? He's like, I'm gonna slide up in that tonight. I fuck that whenever I want. I was like, fuck,
fucking Jerry Joe,
fucking awful, man. I was like, this is so awful.
Danny McBride, that guy is great.
Oh, hilarious, dude. Yeah. He's bounding down, fucking a funny show, man.
Fucking great, yeah.
Lane says,
the only thing I remember from that awful form is his smashing a planet in the face of his original boss, a giant white space lady. Yuck.
Did we get Jeremy's gun? Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Granny Goodness is trying to, you know, send everything she has at Superman, and man, he fucking just pops her. He's like, you know, fuck you, and boom.
And it's a fucking wall up, right? She's like, oh,
yeah,
shit.
Yeah, I don't know if he's fucking dead because he has the armor. You know, that's powered by the mother box.
Yeah, and I feel like this Superman really doesn't know how to hold back a lot because he's used to just being this fucking blunt instrument, this weapon of destruction. So he's just like, I'm just going to sock you as hard as I fucking can. You know what I mean?
So I'm like,
I'm amazed people's fucking heads either don't explode like a pimple or fucking fly off their fucking shoulders. Because I'm like, Superman just unloading on you is going to not be good.
Like, fuck you. Like, I don't even know how powerful Granny Goodness is, but I know she's not that powerful.
Right, yeah.
And then, you know, him and Bardo meet up and she's like, you know, we can run away. We can leave Darkseid. And, you know, he's like, he's going to find us. He, you know, that's all he's going to do. He's going to hunt us and he's going to find us wherever we go. We have to, you know, we have to go confront Darkseid, you know? And she was like, and then, you know, she's like, kisses him, you know? And it's like, oh shit. Like Superman and Bardo.
Like, I know. I was like, whoa, what's going on here? Whatever. Which again was a nice change from the traditional. You know, again, like I said, when Lois fishes him out of the harbor in issue 2, I thought it was going to be straight up like love at first sight type thing. That's what usually happens with them too.
Yeah.
So I like that it was a little bit refreshing that it didn't go that way.
So Superman starts getting ready. He goes back to Earth and he starts getting ready because that's where Darkseid's going to hit.
Mm-hmm.
He starts saying to everyone, look, I'm not that guy anymore. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm on your side now. Let's get everything going. You know, and there's like a big war that's happening on Earth.
Yeah.
And, you know, he goes right after Darkseid, you know. And, you know, he goes, bravo, Kal-El. I did not expect to see you again.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, it will take more than that sadist Desaad to stop me.
Yeah.
And he goes, yeah, I taught you well, but not well enough, it seems, or you would never have returned to fight a battle you cannot win.
Damn.
And you're just like, damn.
It's just like, talking shit, man.
Yeah. And, you know, they're just back and forth while, you know, everyone's having an all-out war. I mean, it's, you know, this is it. You can feel like this is the
– right.
The fucking big battle between, you know, Genesis and Apokolips.
I thought the books did a good job of building up to this point, because this is what I was waiting for. Like, I was like, I'm ready to see these fuckers
fight. Yeah, and now, then, like, you know, finally him and Darkseid go at it, and there's like panel after panel after panel of them just, you know, going back it's and
worth
forth.
It. Like, it's yeah. like, I was like, that. This is what made me be like, I need to own this and trade. Like, I need to own this and trade.
And then, you know, this is what Seaman is kind of saying. It's like, Darkseid's kind of like beating him down, and he's like getting up, like slowly, like from the ground, and he goes, you know, turn and face me, Darkseid. We're not finished. And, you know, he's, you know, pretty battered up. And, you know, that's what Superman, I mean, that's what CM has always said about Superman, is his durability. This guy
absolutely
can take a fucking pounding.
Yeah.
And he's going to give it back, though. But, he's not going to stop until all his energy is
and know, again, spent. That comes from, I think, that conviction and that iron will to see something through, especially if it's a cause he believes in, and especially if it's people that he loves, to see it through. And that is one of the main things that really comes through in that Superman and Lois show, is that, you know, this guy is all now, you know, I know Superman has a kid now in the comics, you know, Jonathan Kent, whatever, but, you know, in this show, it's like he's got two kids, whatever. And I haven't read a lot of those Jonathan Kent comics, but it's like, I mean, as we see how he is when it comes to Lois, and when he's like that when it comes to his kid, how any one of us are would be when we come to our kid. Exactly the guy you think he's going to be, where it's like, you do not fuck with him.
And then Lane says, if you do Batman Who Laughs story, read the Batman Who Laughs miniseries.
Okay.
It is amazing in all caps.
Nice.
And Lane says, this is the best Lex Luthor look he had for years. And there you go. Lane says, Ed Asner is the one who voices Granny Goodness.
Great.
Yes. That's what I was saying. I was like, man, that's fucking nasty. Damn.
I love Ed Asner. Yeah. Yeah, he was also Santa, wasn't
he? He passed away. And then Cobra Kai, too.
Yeah, the dad.
And then Jeremy says, all right, y'all convinced me. Now I got to read it.
There you go, Jeremy.
And 14 Wellington is here.
Wellington is here. Yeah, me and F. Wellington had a good talk offline or whatever about that this is not his, you know, real name or whatever. And I won't say your real name, F. Wellington, without your permission. But that he ran into a guy that had his same name on a couple of groups or whatever. And so that's why he, you know, kind of came up with an alias, whatever, which is totally fine, dude. I'm going to keep calling you that because me and AA use aliases as well. You know what I mean? To an extent. I mean, you can call me Chuck in real life, but yeah.
Yeah, and then here's like a big moment. You know, they stab Light Ray. And right before he goes, he powers the shit out of Kal-El, Superman.
Yeah.
With his light.
Yes.
And Superman gets like super fucking charged. Or even the Omega Beam is not even working because he's like full on superpower here. Because
he hits him with the first round of it, right? And he's like, that was just a fraction, he tells him. And then later on, you know, well, go ahead, I'll let you.
Yeah, he goes, you know.
This part is so great. Because I was like, man, like, it's fucking, you know, he needs to get juiced.
So Superman goes, you know, Light Ray gave his life so I can, you know, end your reign of terror. He goes, his sacrifice was in vain, Kal-El. He takes it only a fraction of the power of my own Omega Beams earlier. This time I will not be so gentle. Which then Superman says, is that the best you can do? And, you know, Darkseid is like shitting bricks here. He's like, it's impossible. No one has ever withstood the full force before.
And that's the part. Like, this is the part, like, where you're in your, like, your comic reading chair. You're like, yeah, like, fuck
then,
yeah.
And then Superman, you know, he tells him, you taught me never to accept defeat. He's saying this to Darkseid. You taught me never to go down.
Right.
And, you know, Darkseid's like, perhaps I taught you too well, my son. I was like, oh, like, damn, like, he accepting him.
And then the comeback line.
Yeah, he goes, once and for all, I'm not your son. And he just fucking wallops him with the fucking right
hook. Left hook.
And, man, he knocks his ass out. Boom.
Yeah, and you're like, I think even then people are like, is he dead? Like, did he fucking kill him?
Yeah, like, everyone's like, whoa, what the fuck?
And I think he says something like, his kind of evil never really dies or something.
It goes, with Darkseid unconscious and his mental defenses down, we can exercise the universe of Darkseid's corruption by letting the source work through all of us together and return Darkseid to the heart of creation where his dark soul may be purified.
So it's not like a death sentence in the sense it's meant to, it almost sounds like a super rehab type thing, whatever.
Yeah, big time.
But I do not see that
like, wow, it was like a definitive end for Darkseid, you know, like,
but can you uncorrupt the most corrupted though?
Well, see,
they say his dark soul will be purified, so they're saying he's going to like some type of hell,
what I've read before is that, you know, Darkseid was like them, like New Genesis. And he started killing the old gods. And he started getting their power, but at the same time it was corrupting them. Where he starts turning into Darkseid.
Interesting.
But he was like Highfather.
It
looked like them. You know, so
then he turned to this
so he started getting corrupted. And so I think what it is that his his soul is going to be kind of purified to where it used to be.
That is such an interesting fucking story. Right? Like, I cannot believe that this is not more like well known for DC, but it's like sometimes people are like, oh, they have crappy villains and all that, or whatever, except for Batman. And I'm just like, dude, that's fucking so rich. Like, I would watch an animated New Gods movie. That, if they did that, I'd be like, okay, this is
cool. It's really interesting. Like Kirby, what he wasn't able to do, but his vision of what he wanted.
I get
was
it.
It's so fucking cool. It's so, you know,
he just needed someone to take that vision and probably like pen it out, and it would have been really, really great.
Yeah.
So comments rolling in here. Let's get to Lance Guy says here.
The outfit that Superman is wearing at the very end, though, it's got a New God feel, but not one of his better Superman outfits. But yeah, but you know what? You kind of hit it on the head. It's a New God look.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're probably trying to think what Kirby have kind of given him.
Show that cover, though. Yeah. I don't like the you know what? I'm lying. I was gonna say I don't like the Shepherd stuff, but you tilt it back a little bit. There you go.
Right there.
Lane, I'm such a big Superman guy. If they made this a figure, not a statue, I wouldn't get it. But if they made a figure of that, I would definitely buy that. I would definitely buy that. In fact, they should put that one and the armor one in a fucking two pack.
Right. I mean, his his dark and the redemption.
Yeah. Yeah. And people will be like, what story is that from? They get real hype, you know?
The book did a nice job using the pages had to tell its story and went for it. It's what the Elseworlds are for, doing stuff that we cannot see in regular continuing.
Absolutely.
Like, if they actually gave an ending to Darkseid. You know what I mean? You know, so that's kind of like a cool what if.
Although I feel like there's a little vagueness in what they said. Like, what does that mean? His soul be purified? Like, what? Like, you're not going to turn, you cannot turn the ultimate evil good. You know what I mean? Like, in my opinion, but.
So he is AA, and his name is not Arn Anderson. I feel a little deceived.
No, he's not Arn Anderson.
Yeah, so, like, my initials are AA, so I am AA.
Yeah, so he always said, man, I can't call myself AA because Arn Anderson calls himself AA. But he is our enforcer, though.
The new gods, you know, kind of build a world on Earth, and Lois is with Orion, who is taking the leadership
role. And at first, as I was going through the panels, I was looking real close at the art right away. I was like, are they holding hands?
Yeah.
And I was like, what the fuck, Lois? Like, I was a little bit angry. And I was like, oh no, he's just showing her around by the hand. Until I got further along, then I was like, oh, what the fuck? I was like, okay, like, you know, there is a multiverse where Lois Lane is not with Superman or with Lex.
Meanwhile, Superman has gone back to Apokolips to lead Apokolips into a better world now.
I like that. I like that he didn't adopt Earth as his home and stay there. He's like, I'm going to go back and, in a sense, rule AA? Do you feel like rule fix?
Fix.
Make it
with Barda, because, like, he starts seeing shit grow on, like, one of the last panels.
Yeah, they're
on
terraforming, Apokolips. She says. Yeah. And I love that where he finally had his hair and he looked at his blue and red. I was like, this is my guy, right?
Yeah, and you know, it's like, you know, it's going to take decades. It's like, so Apokolips' most fearsome gladiator has become its most celebrated farmer. You know, and it's like,
farmer?
Yeah. And, you know, he goes, that was the prophecy of the Source Wall. The war will end when Destroyer becomes creator.
Yep.
Yeah, so, I mean, yeah. So, and it starts growing. It starts life. There's a sun there.
What is he doing, Double A? Creating life.
Yeah.
Making him a god. Like Superman the god, you know what I mean? I was like, what the, I mean, I was just like this is such a fucking cool story.
And he goes, after Apokolips we began reseeding new genesis,
right? So he wants to go right his wrongs, you know what I mean?
And then at the end, it doesn't say the end, it has like his symbol that says the beginning.
Yeah, which I was like, man, right for a sequel, right? Like, we never got it.
No,
like, it's like people just, this is like the story that people forgot.
Yeah,
like,
it really is. It really fucking is.
Yeah, like, people can, you know, talk about, you know, the whole, you know, Batman on the source, on the what's the chair called?
The Mobius chair.
The Mobius chair and the three Jokers thing, and everybody was all hyped for that. I'm like, nobody's thinking about this story? Like, dude, it's ripe for a sequel. It's ripe for an animated movie. I think people would love it. I think that people would fucking, you know, want to see these figures. You know, I mean, would you know, as Lane said, want to see a statue. I mean, that black armor is so enticing.
It really is.
And it would just look cool with him, like, on a fucking mountain of, like, bodies, maybe, or whatever, you know what I mean? And then, you know, you just, with, like I said, the cape. Damn, it would be really, really badass. And I would settle for some fucking kick-ass looking McFarlane figures. That would be...
I really wish they would release an Elseworlds toy line.
When you looked up the toy AA, what did you search? You just searched.
I think I just put Superman Darkseid figure. Okay. I think so.
Okay, I gotta look that up.
But I mean, that would be cool. They just kind of released that kind of Elseworlds line, because they did that with Kingdom Come.
Mm-hmm.
They released a whole Kingdom Come series of those characters. Those figures,
yeah. And it's funny, guys. You know, me and AA have been on a little bit of like wanting to read stuff that we had or had heard about or that was hard to find, to only find out that it's still hard to find. You know, we talked about the Super Spider-Man Blue.
Yes.
But it finally got re-released or whatever. Yeah. I don't think, did I say I got mine?
No, you didn't.
Dude, I got, it's like a large format. It's like big. Yeah, it's like a big.
I kind of read it because it has like something addition.
Okay.
And I was kind of like, okay, this is going to be different than the regular one. But right. I still saw the original. It's still going for a shitload of money.
Yeah hard to find. And it's just weird that, like, you know, like, here's a story that like, we remembered. Right? Yeah. Like, and that we liked. That and it's just, like, hard to get. And then, you know, to hear what you told me about this one, Superman the Darkseid, and then what Lane says, like, it's out of print. I'm like, why? Like, why are you guys not keeping these stories out there, whatever?
It's
like,
crazy, right?
Yeah. I mean, I own, like, 2 copies of Kingdom Come. I own, like, 3 copies of V for Vendetta.
You can find that shit it's everywhere.
Like, I mean, if you go to fucking Barnes & Noble to find that shit. Right now, you go to Barnes & Noble, you can get The Watchmen, you can get Dark Knight, and I get it because those are the big classics. But there's other stories that, like, I'm sure people are talking about. How often, remember when we did Born? We were looking for Born. Yeah. It took me a while. I had a hard time finding Born in the hardcover. And then I got this hardcover that was kind of like beat up, whatever. It's still badass, but yeah.
Yeah.
But damn, like I said, thank you, man, because this is such a fun story. It was a good story. A fun story.
And kind of going over this with you again, I was just getting pumped all over again.
And I mean, again, I liked with you reading along because I was like, I forgot like some of the great dialogue. Like Lane said, it's really great with Superman and Darkseid. Because again, this is what you've been wanting. Like, we've been wanting like this. This is what we could have got on screen, man. This is what we could have got on screen, you know. But man, I hope, you know, maybe this one, I always have high hopes for our episodes, but it would draw some traffic and maybe we'll tell DC, hey, drop a re-release. DC drops it. And then after that, you reinvigorate the interest. You get that DC animated movie going or whatever. And then who knows? I mean, it was just really cool. And again, I'm not familiar with the New Gods. So that was a little bit. And again,
and I kind of felt like it was slow. Introduction a little bit for you with them, you know?
Yeah.
Because like I said, the vision was so cool of what he wanted, Kirby. Mm-hmm. It's just, for whatever reason, DC, I guess, was like thinking, oh, so, you know, you're the guy, not really Stan Lee, you know? And then it turned out, you know, well, Jack didn't have a hand for writing.
Yeah.
You know, so it's kind of like, oh, shit, you know, so. His vision never got completed. I would really have liked to have seen what it would have been like, his vision. So
yeah,
but like again, I mean, his characters, his stories have been used over and over and over.
And the man clearly was a visionary or whatever. You know, it's kind of like we say about George Lucas sometimes, whatever. It's like, the guy really couldn't write dialogue, whatever.
Great with great fucking ideas and shit like that. But yeah,
he spun quite the universe. Yes. Whatever. I mean, sometimes though, you need a little bit of a
Spielberg to look at his creative, genius.
Yeah, you know? or you know, Coppola and Puzo, you know what I mean? It's like together they told that richer story, you know what I mean? So we love that.
Lane says, due to Darkseid outfit, based on the panel, flame effects from the fire pit, Krato looking imposing, man, it would be amazing.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I really love the way this Darkseid looked, you know, with that black, like, V suit, the black
boots. And even when Lightray powered him up, man, he looked fucking cool, Superman. Too. Yeah, when he powered up for that last bit with Darkseid, where he really gave him all the strength he needed. Yeah.
What cool. Do you think about Darkseid's look, though? How it's a little bit different than his traditional costume. Yeah. You know what I mean?
He's still big.
Yeah. In black.
Yeah.
I mean, like the key element that, you know, you're looking at Darkseid, whatever.
But, it's just so cool is that, you know, again, Superman destroys the planet. Mm-hmm. I mean, he kills Kalibak. I'm going to say he killed Desaad and Granny Goodness, too. I'm going to say that it powered him enough that, you know, it really knocked those fuckers out completely. Mm-hmm. Darkseid, you know, killing Mannheim and like 3 other people, I believe. Luther, just get rid of, you know,
Slave Luther to Granny Goodness.
Sex slave, yeah. And you're not going to be a fucking, you know, a main character in this story. You're boom, gone. Yeah.
I'm telling you, I think if they dropped this as a DC anime, would people's jaws be on the floor?
Yeah, like, it would be.
Did you fucking see that one? That was fucking nuts.
And like you said, too, Lois ending up with Orion and Superman ending up with Barda. I mean, there's like, oh, wow. Like, they really went for it.
You know? They did. I mean, like, well, I hope it wouldn't leave a bad taste in people's mouth. I mean, like, it's like an alternate, you know, story.
I mean, it'd be like Kingdom Come when he winds up with Wonder Woman.
Yeah. You know? I thought that was cool at the time. I mean, Lois was dead. He was single. You know what I mean,
big time for a long time.
You know, but yeah, again, I can't thank you enough. I'm a great share. I'm always up to read a Superman story, but this one was like really fun.
Yeah, it was really good,
and it was fun that Darkseid was the antagonist, and there was like, you know, them again too. We didn't really, they didn't give us that right away. They built to it, mm-hmm. which is what we always say. It's like, hey, you gotta like do mm-hmm. some storytelling. Like, build this, you know, tell the story, you know, like we say in wrestling, tell the story in the ring, and then you get, and then you give us the big payoff. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Yeah. So, and it did that extremely well. Cause I, like I said, by the end, I was really like, come on, read so I could get to the fucking fight. And I was like, holy shit, it was badass. Like, it was like worth it, man. It was worth it to see. I'm going to go and check out those Superman animated series episodes because I want to get more of them two fighting, whatever. Yeah. And look at that. They put it in DC Unlimited. I mean, Justice League Unlimited. Mm-hmm. They put it in that because why? That's who you want to see. Yep. That's the fucking fight.
Yep.
Fuck Sex Slave Luther. You know what I mean?
Sex Slave Luther.
Yeah. I know you said Rob Liefeld said he wants to see him in the green suit. Yeah, me too. But, you know, I'll take Sex Slave Luther if I can get him, you know?
Big time.
You know, what did Channing Tatum do? He's probably not busy.
Damn, Channing Tatum as Luther?
And he'll be like, damn. We're casting you as like Luther, however.
Damn, you remember This Is the End?
You remember This Is the End? Danny McBride comes out.
Granny Goodness McBride.
Yeah, when he looks in the, what is it, the Righteous Gemstones?
No shit, right?
That fucker looks crazy.
No shit.
That fucker is crazy as hell. Who we got here? Mark Pearson in the house says, heading home now. Hopefully I didn't miss too much. No, you're all good, Mark. I mean, we're almost wrapping it up. But, I mean, I hope you'll go back and watch, man. Again, Mark, I really enjoyed you last night on After Dark as well, man. Beautiful words and just, dude, you know, as you guys always say, you love to see it. I love to see you guys opening up, being supportive, and just, you know, dude, it really, you know, made me feel like that it was okay for guys to feel that way.
And it needs to. Sometimes it just needs to.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, and again, I know we all say we kind of find humor in things, whatever, and there's no humor in the situation, but it made me think a little bit about, like, you know, Fight Club, you know, when it's like, now you cry, you know what I mean? Like, and it's like, you know, and that's how, you know, Cornelius was able to sleep. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, there is something to that. You know what I mean? Yeah. So, but it was really great, man. And, you know, you guys doing that, but yeah, Mark, I don't know if you read comics or you just collect, statues and figures and things, but we talked Superman the Darkseid tonight, a fantastic 3-issue series from 1998 with Superman and Darkseid as the main protagonist. And what if Superman landed on Apokolips and not Kansas. Earth and not in Kansas? A terrifying prospect and that cost the whole planet. Like you said, Double A, Superman killed a planet of people, you know what I mean? And he murdered, you know what I mean, Kalibak or whatever. It's like things that we don't really know Superman to do, except Zack Snyder's Superman who murdered Zod. Well, and we know that Christopher Reeve murdered Zod too. Everyone was like, where do you think he went when he threw him off that thing? I was like, to hell. He went to hell. That's where he went. Fuck, Double A. Yeah, this is a fun one, man. Yeah, it was good. So good to read comics. I don't have a lot more else to say.
That was
man.
It.
Just if you guys get a chance, somehow, some way, find
Superman,
it.
Superman, the Darkseid, and spell just like the regular how you would spell Darkseid, not like the character.
Superman, the Darkseid, just so we have it down here at the bottom.
Yeah, yeah, just like that.
I don't have a lot else, guys. It's just been great talking with you guys. Lane, I want to thank you so much for being here and talking bad.
Yeah, I'm glad you gave us your comments,
especially since you said it was your favorite Elseworlds story. That's always a big claim.
And it's cool that you're gonna look forward to.
yeah absolutely. I hate when something is my favorite and I don't own it. Like, it eats me up inside. Like, I'm like, I got to get a copy of that. Like, once we went down the rabbit hole with Bourne, I was like, why don't I have it? I need to have this now.
When I read it, I was just like, wow.
Yeah. And
this is amazing.
Single issues are great. I love, if I can get a single issues, I will get them. That's fine. But if I get me a nice hardcover to go in the bookshelf so I can read it at my leisure, mm-hmm. even better. And great suggestions too, Lane. So we know we've got a request for a Dark Phoenix Saga. Deceased, welcome back, Frank. We talked about doing Ronin or whatever, and then some things to watch: the Long Halloween animated, Doom That Came to Gotham animated, and then a comparison, if possible, Gotham by Gaslight, the animated movie, versus Gotham by Gaslight, the comic. I'd love to read them both. You know what I mean? So
I want to say, how goes it, fellas? You're on mute for me right now, driving.
No worries at all, man. All good. Yeah, things are good. So we appreciate you being here. Or as the now watch the Collecting Weekly guys throw up one of these. And then the Batman Who Laughs story. So I think that'd be a good one too, Double A. I mean, always time.
I've seen that at Walmart too. It's
fun. Oh, really? Yes. Yeah. Even Walmart has gotten in the comic book game where you can pick
the Batman ones for sure.
Double A, what do we have in the coming weeks? Anything that you can think of or things that I know we've talked about a lot of things. I'm currently in my rewatch of Better Call Saul. We definitely want
to got that. I've been loving the two seasons of The Punisher coming up. We got What We Do in the Shadows probably coming up in a few weeks. We got Star Wars Rebels. We got Ahsoka, probably be somewhere around September,
however long, because we've set the schedule when that's going to end already. So we'll definitely be doing that around my birthday, probably in September.
Yeah, so we got a few things that's probably going to be, you know, for August and September. And then October, heading into October, will probably be our horror month
again. We usually do horror all October long. Yeah. We put kind of whatever else came out to the side. But, man, some great suggestions. So plenty of time to read things for us to read things and things that we're trying to get a few
Superman, more Superman, either, you know, the Superman Lois, the cartoon Superman.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're trying to fit as many Superman stories as we can. It's his 85th anniversary.
Absolutely.
So, I mean,
the man.
Yeah. I mean, it's the greatest comic book character of all time. So.
And Double A's been talking Reservation Dogs. And I think.
That'd be cool.
Number one, I'm up for a rewatch because it's so funny and fun.
Again, Reservation Dogs, season 3, episode 3. Yeah. You don't have to see the entire series. Just check out that episode. It's a really brutal fucking kind of look at our history on how we treated Native Americans. It's pretty brutal looking.
Double A, off the top of your head, does episode 1 of season 3 do any kind of recap, or do they talk about what happened, or it just goes into it?
Okay,
I was just curious because I mean, like, I know I'll burn through that one quick because it's short episodes, and it's just fun and funny, so I like it.
And it's funny because I kind of watched it by myself, and then my wife really got into it too, so she had been watching it with me too. So
great stuff, man. I got nothing else, guys. So we'll say what we say at the end of every episode. We'd like to remind you guys. Before I do that, though, real quick, guys, you guys know that if you're watching us on the CW stream, you know, we're as guest panelists, whatever, and we are very grateful for our time with CW, but we never know when that may end. So I do want to invite everyone, you know, should you want to continue to be a fan of Just Another Friday Night, we hope that you will. Please come check us out at our website here. It takes you right to our link tree, which will take you to our Instagram, our Facebook, our YouTube, our Spotify, and our TikTok. We hope that you will subscribe on all those. Give us 5 stars on Apple. Give us 5 stars on Spotify. We're at JAFN Podcast on most places, YouTube, Spotify, TikTok, Instagram, and Facebook. Subscribe, like, follow, and share. Again, JAFN for Just Another Friday Night. We have a Facebook group. It is called the Friday Night Faithful, where we talk about shit just like this. You want to drop in suggestions like Lane did here today in the comments. Lane, please go there. Become a member. We approved you almost right away. It's got like 500 members, I think, or 400, 300. It might be lower than that. And not everyone contributes. It's
like 400 it's kind or 500.
Of a, yeah, like every group, there's like a core group of people that contribute all the time, whatever. But we welcome that kind of stuff. Tell us things to read. Tell us things to watch. Tell us what you're watching. Share videos. Share clips. That's all we really do in there. You know what I mean? Like, you know, we post up things like that and share our thoughts. You know, I just had a thought the other day about the X-Men 97 cartoon that's going to come out. And I was thinking, like, man, are they going to cover Age of Apokolips? Are they going to cover Legion's Quest? Are they going to cover, what was the other freaking story, Double A? It was the big X-Men one after that cartoon ended. I can't remember what it was, but I was like, gosh, that'd be so cool. Onslaught. Gosh, that would be I really hope you're gonna do that, Double A, like the old style. And I hope it just picks up where it left off.
I really tell those
stories because man, I remember, you know, for the longest time, right, Double A was that mystery of that message of Bishop in the X-Mansion. Yep. To see that in animated form, oh my gosh, you know, the reveal of Onslaught, I just think fans would really, really geek for that. So I'm super hoping for that for X-Men 97. And I just posted that thought in our group, the Friday Night Faithful. So if you haven't done it, please go join and be a member. Yes, Lane, have a good night. Thank you so much for contributing again. We hope we'll see you in the Friday Night Faithful group. We hope that you'll give our page a like, follow, and share, and our YouTube subscribe on our channel. But guys, with that being that aside, Badfish says, take care, everyone. Take care, Badfish. Thank you so much, brother. With that being said, we'd like to say at the end of every show, guys, unless you have something else, we'd like to remind you guys, if there's something that you want to do, a hope, a dream, something that you wish to accomplish, go out and do it. Today is the day. Yes, you have a good one too, Jeremy. Something that you want to do, a hope, a dream that you want to accomplish, go out and do it. Today is the day. Don't waste time. Don't wait another minute. Seize the day, guys. Carpe diem, right? I mean, it's like there's no time like the present. You want to make a podcast. You want to read a comic book. You want to go hunt down that grail. Dude, go do it. You know what I mean? Like, life is short, man. You know, we've learned that. We've all experienced
things. Too short.
This year's been crazy. You know what I mean? So, you know, go do it. You know, we created this show on a whim. We had never talked about it as kids. We never had plans to be doing this now. And here we are 3 years later, still loving it, still meeting new people and enjoying the conversations. So guys, seize the day. The other thing we'd like to say at AA, right, is we like to quote the great Captain Steve Rogers. And this line is even in this comic book, guys.
Yeah, no shit.
When Captain Steve Rogers reminds the Avengers on their way back to the time heist that they're going to have to do whatever it takes to bring back half of the population that Thanos snapped out of existence, guys. So we want to remind you, do whatever it takes, guys. Make it happen. Make those dreams happen. It's the same message as seize the day, essentially. But yes, Toy Mafia, thank you guys so much as well for being here, hanging in there the whole time. But guys, yeah, seize the day, do whatever it takes, guys. I'm CM Chuck.
I'm Double A.
We're Just Another Friday Night. Good night, and we'll see you guys next Friday.